ultimately they causes peripheral vasoconstriction. That's why vasodilator therapy is needed in acute worsening of heart failure. In acute worsening of heart failure, we should understand the mechanism of tissue congestion as well as vascular congestion. Usually we target vascular congestion. We diagnose vascular congestion with clinical signs like increased AVP, orthopnea, third heart sound, bendopnea, biomarkers like NT-proBNP, hemoconcentration, and other techniques. But in tissue condition, we can diagnose it by pitting edema, rails, ascites, and with newer biomarkers like bioadenomedulin, soluble CD146, CA125. They are newer biomarkers through which we can diagnose tissue condition. In technique, we can see the chest, we can do the chest radiography, we can do pulmonary ultrasonography, in which we can see the B lines, and thoracic CT scan or other tests through which we can diagnose tissue congestion. If patient is not responding to the vascular congestion, then we can give drugs which help in relieving tissue congestion, like SGLT2 inhibitors and talvepton type of drugs. Here we can see the site of action of natriuresis and aquaretic drugs in the nephrons. So we can see the SGLT2 inhibitors, they are smart diuretics and they act on proximal coronary tubule. Natriuresis with loop diuretics, they act on ascending loop of Henle, and aquaresis with vasopressin antagonist, they act on collecting duct. So how to identify need of tissue congestion relieving therapy? First, identify increased intracardiac pressure and intravascular congestion, as I have told you earlier, and biomarkers are very helpful, and then we can choose the drugs. Now, current and potential new drug therapies in treatment of heart failure. Before one decade, actually, we don't have that type of drug which actually cover all the pathophysiological mechanism of heart failure. But in last one decade, there are so many new drugs which are coming up, and they have changed the treatment of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction in a very large extent, like neprilysin inhibition, RAS inhibition, SGLT2 inhibition, aldosterone inhibition, and sympathetic nervous system inhibition. Now we can also add soluble guanyl cyclase stimulator, IV iron therapy, myosin activator, evobradine, and fixed dose hydralazine and isosorbide dinitrate. So these are the newer targets. Baseline therapy in various heart failure are ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist combination, vasodilators, IF channel blocker, angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibition, sodium glucose co-transporter 2 inhibitor, soluble guanyl cyclase stimulator, and myosin activator. So now we have so many drugs for heart failure treatment. So since last one decade, there are so many societies, they have endorsed new drugs in their guidelines, like ARNI has replaced ACE inhibitor during the last decades, and SGLT2 inhibitors come up, and now the new drugs like omecamtiv, mercabil, and varisigat are coming. So these are the recent guidelines and recommendation. They are increasingly recognized ARNI as a treatment across all the spectrum of EF. Now ACC-2021 consensus initiating and optimizing guideline directed medical therapy. So heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, STACI treatment. Initially we start with ARNI, beta blocker, and diuretic agent if needed. And then we can add aldosterone antagonist, SGLT2 inhibitor, diuretic agents, hydralazine and isosorbide dinitrate, evobradine, as per requirement of the patient, as per symptoms of the patients. And key changes in the treatment recommendation for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction patient, ARNI is actually preferred first line renin angiotensin aldosterone antagonist in HAPROF patient. And for patient in whom ARNI administration is not possible, so ACE inhibitor or ARB is recommended. SGLT2 inhibitors are added in as part of therapy for patient with chronic HAPROF who are already receiving beta blocker and ARNI, ACE and ARB and aldosterone antagonist if not contraindicated. So these are the new things. Now, European Society of Cardiology Heart Failure Guideline 2021 recommendation for the management of HAPROF. So they are also saying the same thing, that is the four classes of drugs are very important: ACE inhibitor, ARNI, beta blocker, MRAs, and SGLT2 inhibitors. Now 2021 update to the 2017 ACC expert consensus. They are saying there are 10 points which are very important for treatment of heart failure patient, like we should initiate and add on or switch the therapy, titration of the drugs, referral system should be there, care coordination should be there, adherence, specific patient cohort, medication cost and assess, increasing complexity, comorbidities and palliative hospital care. So these 10 points they have addressed in this paper, and these are the drugs for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, and these are the starting dose and these are the target dose. So this I have already discussed. Now indication for use of an ARNI. ARNI is usually used if ejection fraction is less than 40%, NYHA class 2 to 4 heart failure, and administered in conjunction with a background of GDMT for heart failure in place of ACE inhibitor or ARB. Indication for use of evobradine we can use in ejection fraction less than 35%, and patient should be on maximum tolerated dose of beta blocker, and patient should be in sinus rhythm with resting heart rate more than 70 beats per minute, and patient should be in NYHA class 2 to 3. Indication for use of SGLT2 inhibitor, HAPROF patient with EF less than 40% with or without diabetes. This we can use without diabetes also. This is very important. And NYHA class 2 to 4. And we can use this drug with guideline-directed medical therapy for heart failure. Now, what are the dose adjustment technique of ARNI in a special situation? So we can start with lower dose if patient blood pressure is less or patient renal condition is, renal impairment is there. And we can up titrate according to the situation of patient, and we can go up to the 100 milligram BD dose. Now, what are the contraindication for starting ARNI or sacubitril valsartan? So within 36 hour, ACE inhibitor should not be used. History of angioedema should not be there with ACE or ARB. There should not be pregnancy, lactation, severe hepatic impairment, and hypersensitivity with either ARB or ARNI. Evobradine is contraindicated if patient is hypersensitive with severe hepatic impairment, acute decompensated heart failure, if blood pressure is less than 90, 6 sinus syndrome, or there is SA node blockage or second or third degree blockage is there, or if pulse rate is less than 60. SGLT2 inhibitor should not be used if patient is having ketoacidosis, UTI, patient is having hypersensitivity to drug, lactation, or on dialysis. So if heart failure patient came to us, then what we'll do, we'll first evaluate the patient, then we will investigate the patient with BNP, pro-BNP, all blood tests with HbA1c, ECG, chest x-ray, echocardiogram, and other tests. And then we can start medication, that is guideline-directed medical therapy, as recommended by various societies. And then we can titrate slowly patient, and then we can maintain on the drug if patient is stabilized, and again we can investigate patient what is their blood reports. But if patient is not stabilized or response is poor, then we should remember one acronym, I need help. And in this situation we should refer the patient, like if patient is on IV inotropes, patient is NYHA class 3B or 4 and patient is not improving, or patient is having persistently elevated natriuretic peptide, or patient is having end organ dysfunction, ejection fraction less than 35%, patient is, we have to give defibrillator shock, if patient needs hospitalization, patient is having edema in spite of optimal diuretic therapy, patient is having low blood pressure, or if any prognostic, poor prognostic features, then we should refer this patient to higher center. These are the triggers for heart failure patient referral to a specialist program, as I have discussed. There are few patient cohort in which guideline-directed medical therapy is not actually giving that much expected outcome as we are expecting with these newer drugs, like in African-American patient, older patient, frail patient. So in these patients, we should prognosticate patient in a different manner. Now, these are the trials for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, and these are recent trials due to which we are getting new drugs like ARNI, like vericigert, dapagliflozin, empagliflozin, and omecamtiv mecarbil. So these drugs have changed the treatment protocol of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And the, here in this slide, the inclusion criteria is given. Like in Paradigm HF, the patient were with LV ejection fraction less than 35%, in Victoria less than 45%, in DAPA HF less than 40%, in Emperor reduced less than 40, in Galactic HF less than 35%, and their BNP levels. So these are the inclusion criteria, and these are the recent and ongoing trials. So now we'll discuss about the DAPA HF. So DAPA HF trial is actually a trial of dapagliflozin in patient of chronic heart failure with reduced ejection fraction with or without type 2 diabetes, and 5000 patients were taken, and they were divided into two groups. One were given dapagliflozin and one placebo group, and the results were analyzed for primary endpoint as well as secondary endpoints, and the results was favorable for primary as well as secondary endpoints. Then Emperor reduced trial was there, like for empagliflozin, and this trial was also very important because the patients were more severe and with less ejection fraction group, and they have more severe renal dysfunction. So in primary endpoint as well as first secondary endpoint and second secondary endpoint, in all these subgroup of patient, this study has shown significant result in terms of mortality, in terms of heart failure for hospitalization. So we can see that empagliflozin prevented both serious heart failure patient and serious kidney failure events. So that's why these SGLT2 inhibitors are actually there for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction patient, and we can give dapagliflozin up to eGFR more than 30 and empagliflozin up to GFR more than 20. Now we'll discuss about varisigut. Varisigut is a direct agonist of soluble guanine cyclase, and actually it improves cyclic GMP level directly, and whereas ARNI and other drugs increase cyclic GMP level indirectly. So here cyclic GMP level, when increases, it causes better vasodilatation and anti-fibrotic, anti-proliferative, and anti-inflammatory effect. And one more thing which is very important is that there is no tachyphylaxis is seen in case of varisigut, whereas like in case of NO and hydralazine. So action is also independent of ferric ion induced NO resistance found in case of severe heart failure. So expected to have better effect in black population as seen in NO and hydralazine, and easy to titrate as it causes less hypotension, renal dysfunction, and hyperkalemia. So we can give this drug in hypotension situation, renal dysfunction, and hyperkalemia. This is very important point, because in heart failure patient, if patient is having lower BP and patient is having severe renal dysfunction and hyperkalemia, then options are very less. Even we can't give ARNI in this situation. So this is very important drug which we can add up. And the results are actually, results are very good in primary endpoint. So now here we analyze the results. We can see this graph here. So this drug is suitable for high-risk patient of heart failure, like if EF is even less than 30% and age is more than 65 year. 41% patient were NYHA class 2 and 3, whereas in PARADIGM-HF trial only 25% patient, and in DAPA-HF trial only 32% patient. Mean NT-proBNP level was 2816, which is very high in this subgroup. And whereas in PARADIGM-HF, the mean value was 1608, and in DAPA-HF 1437. 15% patient were taking ARNI here in this population, and potential additive effect with ARNI and SGLT2 inhibitor is there. Now we discuss the our last drug, that is omecamtiv mecarbil. This drug is actually direct myosin activator, and there is two previous trial of omecamtiv mecarbil. One is on acute heart failure, and one is on chronic heart failure. So atomic AHF trial was on acute heart failure, which was not very significant, whereas cosmic HF trial was significant, and it was on chronic heart failure. That's why galactic HF trial was planned, and galactic HF trial has shown significant p-value in primary composite outcome. We can see that here, and the result is actually not due to mortality benefit. The result is due to decrease in heart failure hospitalization. So we can see here NYHA class 3 and 4 patients were taken, and EF was less than 28%. Usually in positive impact was more with hospitalized patient with more NT-proBNP, while results were independent of NT-proBNP in case of OPD patient, and systolic BP less than 100 mmHg of mercury, then this drug was more effective. So with all these discussions, we can analyze that there are four pillars of heart failure treatment. One is ARNI, another is beta blocker, third one is MRA, and now fourth is SGLT2 inhibitor. If there is any drug reaction or any hypersensitivity reaction with ARNI, then we can use ACE inhibitor or ARB. If there is iron deficiency, then we can use ferric carboxymaltase. If there is black population or some racial changes, we can use hydralazine and nitrate. If there is mitral valve dysfunction is there, then we can repair that. If patient is in AF, then we can use digitalis and anticoagulant. If patient is having LBB or void QRS, then we have to go for CRT. If patient pulse rate is more than 70, in spite of optimized beta blocker use, we should start ibabradine. If patient is having feature of congestion, we should start loop diuretic and thiazide diuretic. If patient is presented with recent decompensation and advanced heart failure, then along with these drugs, an optimized dose of these drugs, we can start varisigert, omecamtiv, mecarbil, digitalis, and we can refer patient for LVAD or other therapies. So there are a few subgroup of patients which recover very fast, and few subgroups are patient in which, in spite of these drugs, the result is not very good. So greater recovery in LVEF is occur if there is dilated cardiomyopathy, but it should not be due to coronary artery disease. Patient is younger, woman patient, and if patient is we treat according to guidelines with the optimal proper dose. If patient is having shorter history of heart failure, or patient is having hypertension with absence of diabetes and narrow QRS complex, also results are good. And we can see that this is this slide shows the best effect of guide drugs is present with beta blocker and CRT, and ACE inhibitor, ARB, ARNI, and iron. These drugs also have very good effect. But if patient is having myocardial scar, then this is not true. And few patient improve spontaneously in dilated cardiomyopathy, as we all know that in tachycardiomyopathy, in peripartum cardiomyopathy, if cardiomyopathy is due to toxins like alcohol, iron, and chemotoxins, are Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. So now we'll summarize my talk. So the heart failure incidence is increasing worldwide, and in Asian it presents one decade earlier to Western population. Diagnosis of heart failure requires clear-cut signs and symptoms of heart failure, along with either increased nitrate peptide level or objective evidence of cardiopulmonary condition. Newer terminology, HFrEF, heart failure with mid-range ejection fraction, with preserved, and HF with improved or recovered EFR given by different society, holds importance in terms of stratifying heart failure patient. HFrEF and HFpEF patient are having different pathological trigger and requires different pharmacological therapy. Addressing
Madam, you are not audible.
I think there is some connectivity issue.
Yeah, it seems like. Mishra sir bhi stuck ho gaye, dono jan stuck ho gaye.
This is almost finished also. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Palvi, for a wonderful talk. I think they have gone offline. Just to summarize, though she has extensively covered it for the benefit of all, it is very important to have a detailed clinical history, a good clinical examination, and there are three investigations which are mandatory, an ECG, an echo, and NT-proBNP as a biomarker. Of course, one should always rule out anemia and treat it. And majority of our patients with heart failure are left untreated for anemia and often worsen. Now, diagnosing heart failure with reduced ejection fraction is very easy, and it is a part of what I call clinical medicine. But the diagnosis of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is very difficult, and it requires a very high index of suspicion, and that is where the art of medicine comes in. Just to give you a clinical pointer, in patients who are hypertensive, females, obese, and have atrial fibrillation, always rule out heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Now, as far as the treatment is concerned, it has been, as you very rightly said, that the treatment of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction is based on basically four pillars: the use of the RAS blockers, preferably the ARNIs as the first drug, the beta blockers, the MRAs, and the SGLT2 inhibitors. And all patients in chronic heart failure should be on these four drugs, start low and up titrate to reach the optimum dosage that is been given in the guidelines. That is very important. Majority of the patients I've seen are not receiving the right dosage. So you have to uptrade to reach the right dosage that has been prescribed in the guidelines. Now, coming to the heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, we did not have any specific treatment till now. But recently, besides treating the hypertension, obesity, and metabolic syndrome, and atrial fibrillation, etc., it is very important. Two things have come up. One was the use of sotagliflozin that has shown a wonderful result in one of the trials. And the other is the EMPEROR preserved trial with empagliflozin. The top line results are out, and the main results will be presented in the ACC meeting very soon. And it has shown a significant benefit even in patients with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Of course, ARNIs are there, and they have shown a benefit in a very small subset of patients with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, especially in the mid-range fraction and in females. So I think this is a short summary of what he was trying to tell us. And if there are any questions, please go ahead. Or Dr. N.K. Singh, would you like to comment? Unmute yourself.
Actually, I am in a car, so there is a bit net problem. But anyway, Dr. Birmani has beautifully summarized what was from the talk of Dr. Mishra. She has done a wonderful job by, I think, the all advancement and updates she has given. My only point is that there is a lots of inertia, like therapeutic inertia in starting the SGLT2 inhibitors in the patients of the heart failure, especially the preserved ejection fraction, whatever may be, but even in the reduced ejection fraction. So the recently at the ADA also, Dr. Cherney showed a slide, beautiful slide, how to come over the clinical inertia with the SGLT2 inhibitors. I don't know what is the basis of the stepwise therapy of the ARNI, then MRA, then other things, and then to start SGLT2 inhibitors. So my point, Dr. Birmani, is if Dr. Mishra can explain, or you can explain, why not you start SGLT2 inhibitors from the very beginning of the heart failure, reduce ejection fraction, and as you already told...
I think Dr. N.K., you have got it a bit wrong, because now every cardiologist that I've been talking to, and is also said in all the guidelines also, that once the patient have acute heart failure in the acute stage is stabilized with maybe diuretics and the ARNI and beta blockers should be started almost simultaneously.
Hello.
And at pre-discharge, pre-discharge, the patient should be advised.
Hello.
Both the MRAs and SGLT.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. So what I was saying you should prepare the patient at discharge, that within 15 days of post-discharge, he should be on all the four drugs and simultaneously, and they should be started in low dosages and then up-titrated.
Hello.
As far as the clinical inertia
is concerned.
I was referring for the chronic. Chronic heart failure itself, and there is inertia that is pinwani. You just talk to a cardiologist, you talk to a nephrologist. They are not using it. When there is
inertia, will always be there. Not using it. See, that inertia has always been there. Even after the paradigm HF trial, hardly 20% of the people were getting arnis. In the cardiology practice, I'm talking about cardiology practice.
How to overcome the inertia? That is my question.
That is what, you know, in one of his talks, David Turney, who is a nephrologist in Toronto, said that we come out with wonderful trials, we come out with wonderful results, but unless they're applied in routine clinical practice, it carries no meaning. So that is what is important. And such educative seminars are important, where you emphasize the fact that these are the patients who require all the four drugs. And today, even I have been talking to some cardiologists and nephrologists who have picked up the use of SGLT2 inhibitors even in patients without diabetes. So that is a very good start. That's a very good start. Any comments, Dr. Palvi? Any comments?
Sir, actually, we are using SGLT2 inhibitor from the starting. If there is no contraindication, then we actually, if patient is look, we are starting with ARNI, beta blocker, and SGLT2 inhibitor from the starting point. Absolutely. If there is need, then we add loop diuretics and other drugs.
But so definitely,
SGLT2 inhibitor we are giving even in those patients who are not having diabetes.
Yes, so diabetes, and you should always SGLT2 inhibitor. You should also add an MRI right from the beginning.
Yeah, definitely, so, sir. We add all the four drugs.
Correct.
ARNI, beta blocker, MRA, and this SGLT2 inhibitor.
Yeah. Just one small comment in that, sir.
Dr. Mishra, excellent one, but
yes.
I was thinking that you have started SGLT2 inhibitors like dapagliflozin in a case of non-diabetic heart failure. And patients ask you, sir, aapne diabetes ki dawa mujhe kyun de di hai? Then how that patients ask, why you have given a diabetes?
SGLT2 inhibitor is not an anti-diabetic drug. Actually, we are explaining patient that this drug is for your renal protection, your heart failure prevention, your even actually, it is a vascular medicine drug. So, but we are not using this drug as an anti-diabetic drug.
Dr. Palvi, actually what Dr. N.K. Singh is saying, this will never occur. No patient will ask you anything if you properly educate him and properly tell him why you are using this medicine right at the prescription time. Then you will never face this problem.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. So, we always explain patient about SGLT2 inhibitors and other drugs. Even about ARNI and what are the different precautions a patient should monitor his blood pressure, his other thing to if blood pressure goes below 90, then we should stop this ARNI at that time, or we actually decrease the dose. So definitely we explain about every drug to the patient.
That's very important. I
was planning to make the point that even in the DAPA-HF trial, when they use in the non-diabetic cases, the HbA1c reduction was very low, 0.03%, I think I remember. So it didn't cause any problem for the diabetic status or sugar problem. So I think this is a beautiful drug and we must use it from the very beginning in the proper cases. So this is
the message should go strongly. Any other questions? Dr. Vinay, you want to ask anything?
Just one small comment, sir.
Yes, sir.
In this area, we are talking about all these four pillars of the treatment. Agreed. Universally, the drugs should be given, but the background should be evaluated. Like serum ferritin should be done in each and every patient of heart failure.
Absolutely.
Because
absolutely.
If your patient is having subclinical iron deficiency, then probably Arni is not going to work because of the
I pointed this out when I was offline. I said, don't forget to rule out anemia and treat it.
Yes.
is very commonly found in patients.
Even if your patient is having normal HB, don't forget to do the serum ferritin level. And cutoff value of the serum ferritin is on the higher side. So if it is less than 200 milligram, less than 200, then you should always go with the IV iron therapy. It can dramatically improve the response of the NO-mediated therapy, that is the varisigut and the particularly the mainstay of the treatment, that is ARNI. So response of ARNI depends upon the iron status also. So this is very important.
Very good, very good. Yes, Vinay, you wanted to ask something?
Sir, we have a lot of patients of heart failure with diabetes, CKD, or chronic liver disease and heart failure. So I think choosing a drug like the four pillars would be very, very difficult in all the patients. Patients having a creatinine of 3.5 and having a heart failure, I'm sure using dapagliflozin would be a very, very big challenge. Even ARNI would be a very, very big challenge. And choosing even an MRA would be a very, very big challenge. So I'm sure putting things so strongly in front of everyone is not a correct way of doing it, because
when you say you are treating heart failure, have to know what the patient is having, what other comorbidities is having.
Exactly.
So unless there is no sense in saying that you don't treat heart failure blindly by giving this four drugs. You assess the patient clinically, biochemically, and then give the drug judiciously.
Exactly, sir. This is what I'm trying to say, sir. Whenever
that is there everywhere. You don't if that is not followed, then you are not being clinical.
I have one solution to this problem.
Yeah.
Actually, I got the point which Dr. Vijay is trying to put, that because of the hyperkalemia, we can't give the MRA.
Yeah, yeah.
Because of the reduced eGFR, we can't give the ARNI. Because of the reduced eGFR, we can't give SGLT2 inhibitor. So in those subgroup of patients, what we should do? So,
sir,
this is a problem. This is a challenge. So in that scenario, you have to take a modified approach. So what is that modified approach? Look at the nevolol. Nevolol is one drug which can be given across the all eGFR value, the carbidolol. So beta blocker is one drug which you can utilize very well. In this scenario, if you want to block the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system, you have to manage the potassium very well. So diet restriction with the potassium and probably the use of potassium binders are very important in this scenario. So suppose you are giving potassium binder in this scenario, it will give you a breathing space to use the ARNI, and it will give you a breathing space to use the mineralocorticoid receptor agonist. And suppose you are giving loop diuretics also, it will flush out the potassium and that will give you a room to use the mineralocorticoid receptor agonist. So combining the loop diuretics, giving the potassium binder will open a window of opportunity to use these all four agent in case of heart failure. Because if you don't use these all four agent in the heart failure, probably it will be very disastrous. So modified way of doing things can be done. Another very, very important thing which Dr. Pallavi has already told you in the topic, that is these two new drugs, that is the varisigut and the omecamtiv. These are the two drugs which can be used independent of eGFR, independent of the hepatic involvement, independent of the blood pressure, particularly the omecamtiv markable. So these are the drugs which are the which are there, and they are the future drug. They can be used in this subgroup of patients. So there are a lot more scope of research in this area. So certainly there are caveats. We still need a very ideal drug for the treatment of heart failure, but at least we are on the right path. So with those subgroup of patients, difficult to treat patient where potassium is not permitting, the eGFR is very down, probably up to eGFR 20, we can use the AMPA.
Even hyponatremia becomes a very, very big challenge.
Yes.
You have to monitor and treat.
Yes.
You have to be very
vigilant. For hyponatremia, these drugs which are acting on the tissue congestion like vasopressin antagonists are very, very important. And you need to identify the tissue congestion as well as the vascular congestion. And you have to differentiate between these two disorders. This is a very, very new concept which is coming in the treatment of heart failure. You have to identify that, look, this is the point where the intravascular volume is euvolemia, and not, you are not giving the diuretics in an overdose. So intravascular volume is adequate. Now tissue congestion is the problem. So you have to diagnose the tissue congestion. To diagnose tissue congestion, you have to rely on different parameters like the different biomarkers or B-line in ultrasound and the bendopnea, which is very, very important. But like person who is having dyspnea once he walks through by bending. So and pedal edema is still there. So these are the signs of tissue congestion. So in this subgroup of patient, if the tissue congestion is there, one should go for these tolvaptan or SGLT2 kind of medicine, which can further relieve the tissue congestion. So you should always.
I think the monitoring is very important. Without monitoring the patient, it makes no sense. And that message has to go strongly. These patients should be on all these four drugs. We cannot dilute that message. You have to know how to use those drugs. As simple as that.
Hello. So if you treat heart failure very well, hello.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
We can hear you.
Yes. If you treat heart failure very well, it is going to improve the EGFR as well. So another way of improving the renal function is to adequately treat EGFR. So these are very, very important point, and probably the forum like CardiAppCon is very, very important in this regard. We are moving in the era where a lot of integration is required. So inputs from diabetologist, endocrinologist, the nephrology people is required to treat our patient in a better manner. So this is a very good overlapping area, heart failure, and we diabetologists and the physician which we are using the SGLT2 inhibitor can guide our colleague physician in this regard.
I think that Birmani, we can end here this and we can move to the
We'll end here, and next we will go to I think it's Dr. Ajay Chabra will be talking on insulin initiation or optimization.
Thank you so much, sir, for the presentation.
Dr. Jagmani, please.
Dr. Birmani, sir, and N.K. Singh, sir. Thank you so much. With this, we move on to our next talk. So we are once here at once again at CardiAppCon. These are our knowledge partners. And with that, I welcome Dr. Ajay Chabra for Rewind Pioneer Award. The committee has chosen him for this particular award, the prestigious award of CardiAppCon Society. He will be talking on insulin initiation and optimization. He's a leading consultant and diabetologist and chairman at Diabetes Center, run by him, and also consultant diabetologist at Santa Vita Health Point and Pulse. Also, he is president at Jharkhand RSSDI, member of various national and international societies. He is national speaker at various forums with a lot of national and international publication and research in various fields. So probably he is the person who should receive this particular award. As a token of respect, the society awards him with a medallion, a memento, and a certificate prior to the talk. With this, I hand over the session to Dr. Ajay Chabra for his prestigious Rewind Pioneers Award. Dr. Chabra, please.
Thank you, Dr. Jagnani, and thank you for organizing such an academic feast on a Sunday evening and giving us all this opportunity to interact on various important topics concerning cardiologists and diabetologists alike. My warm good afternoon to all the seniors, Virmani sir, N.K. Singh sir, Dr. Dhandania sir, Dr. Nubu ma'am. It's very nice to see all of you. And my topic for the day will be insulin initiation and optimization. And I'll be just rushing you through some of the slides where we discuss how, with the plethora of medicines which we have, with the number of tablets, number of OHAs which we have, and with the wealth of experience which we have gained in the past so many years, still we are not able to control or keep our type 2 diabetic patients in the target range of their HbA1cs. And despite various drugs available, how we can initiate a patient on insulin, which is the best insulin to initiate, and how do we start, how do we optimize, and how do we bring about the changes in a type 2 patient's quality of life. So just to rush you to the history of insulin, the birth of an idea. In October 1920, Frederick Bantick, a young surgeon in London, Ontario, Canada, first conceived the idea that led to the discovery of insulin. One evening, after delivering a lecture on the pancreas to the medical students, he was struck by an idea. Could the internal secretions of the pancreas be isolated from the external secretions to keep the dogs with diabetes alive? Now, this was a question which came to his mind. And he tied off a pancreatic duct to cause acinar tissue degeneration, thereby removing proteases which were destroying the anti-diabetic principle during its extraction. Banting began his research on May 1921 with MacLeod as a former supervisor. MacLeod was a professor of physiology, and Charles Best, a medical graduate, student as his assistant. In August of 1921, after numerous failures, Banting and Best prepared a new extract from the atrophied pancreas of one of the dogs. They then isolated the two dogs with diabetes, administering the extract to one and leaving the other, second dog, untreated. 4 days later, the untreated dog died of severe diabetes. The dog that received the extract lived for 3 more weeks, dying only when the extract was used up. Majority was the name of the dog. This is the dog we're talking about. And here are Mr. Banting and Mr. And here is Mr. Banting and Mr.
Class kijiye, mummy. Aap to so easy hai.
Should I continue? There's a voice out there.
Yeah. Okay, continue. I think they have
Yeah, so here we have a picture. This is a normal picture we see in every conference. Dr. Banting and Best, and that the dog you see is Majorie, the dog who received the first pancreatic extract and survived for 4 weeks after that and died after that extract was finished. Just to let you know about the history of insulin in India. In India, the first doctor to use insulin was Dr. Bose from Calcutta. He was the first one who used insulin in type 1 diabetic patients in Calcutta and showed how the patient's blood sugar improved and the patients gained weight. And diabetes is also mentioned in our ancient literatures. 3,000 years back, Sushruta and Charaka, the famous ancient physicians of India, almost identified the two different types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2. They saw lean and thin individuals who were losing weight and obese individuals who are passing glucose in their urine. So this is an old disease named as Madhumeh in our literatures and diabetes.
Excuse me,
in
the Dr. Chhabra,
yes,
the slides are not changing.
Oh, one sec, please. Is it okay now? Abhi hai?
Yes, abhi ho rahi hai change.
Yeah. So here we have the first human patient. On January 11, 1922, 14-year-old Leonard Thompson, he was the first human patient to receive insulin made by Banting and Best. The initial test failed, causing only slight reduction in blood glucose level. A second series of purified insulin injections, which was produced by J.B. Collip. Now, J.B. Collip was a chemist, actually, achieved the desired result. He produced a purified insulin injections, and Leonard's blood glucose dropped to normal after that, and he began to gain weight. Evolution of insulin, as you can see. Yeah. 1922, isolation of insulin by Banting and MacLeod. Banting and MacLeod were given Nobel Prize for this. In 1923, animal insulin preparations were given there in the market. 1946, we got NPH. 1950s, insulin series were there. 1977, we had recombinant human insulin. 1990s, Well, it was a game changer. Rapid acting insulin analogs were there. And now we have basal insulin analogs, and we have generation 2 basal analogs as well in the market right now. Evolution of basal insulin, development of generation 1 to generation 2 basal insulin, overcoming limitations. Now, insulin glargine U100 and insulin detemir were developed to overcome some limitations of early basal insulin, such as NPH insulin, with less variable absorption and longer duration of action. Now, NPH came into the market in 1946, and glargine U100, it came into the market in 1992. They overcome some of the limitations of NPH insulin. Mind you, no offense against NPH insulin. It's one of the most important and one of the most prolific used insulin in our practice. More than 50% of the patients who are on basal bolus or on basal insulin in my center are on NPH insulin because they come from socio-economic backgrounds. But Lantus or glargine, as you may call them, have its own advantages. Longer-acting basal insulin like glargine U300 and insulin degludec have since been developed with less variability and more prolonged duration of action, that is more than 24 hours. Now, these are the insulin, various insulin profiles. If you see the graph, this is the graph of NPH, and this is glargine 100. And now we have glargine U300 and insulin degludec, which have perfect flat basal profile, which can be used in type 2 diabetic patients, and after some research, maybe in type 1 as well. Now, this is a landmark, famous landmark study, which is still going on. Our center is one of the part of this study. This is the first large-scale longitudinal prospective observational study to investigate management and complication in type 2 diabetes across India over a period of 3 years. Now, this was the status in India prior to pandemic. And we were surprised to see only 1 in 5 type 2 diabetic patients were on target. They could achieve their HbA1c of less than 7. Now, 81.1% could not achieve the HbA1c target of less than 7, as it was decided or it was pre-decided in the study. There were more than 6,000 subjects in this study. And we could see that more than 75%, almost 75% of the subjects in this study were on oral antidiabetic agents. 24.4% were on oral antidiabetic agents, insulin. And 1.1% of the patients were on OAD non-insulin injectables. And only 0.4% of patients were plainly on insulin, 0.4% on insulin plus non-insulin injectables, and 0.4% on OAD plus insulin plus non-insulin injectables. This was a scenario prior to the pandemic. Now, after the pandemic, there has been many concerns, overreaching concerns during COVID-19 pandemic. The lockdown by itself has made so many changes in our lives that there has been restricted movement. There has been reduced access to the healthcare resources, medications, and glucose test strips. There has been missed follow-ups by different patients. Every day we are seeing patients who are coming to our centers after 8 months, 12 months, 2 years. Yesterday I saw a patient who came after 4 years. Sir, lockdown ke wajah se nahi aa paya tha. But then the patients are missing their follow-ups. They're missing their laboratory tests. Their visits to healthcare providers is being missed. There is restricted time for interaction, leading to lack of counseling and training. There are challenges with remote monitoring of blood glucose levels. This is the biggest challenge we have. There is lack of adequate troubleshooting, correction of injection technique, and use of insulin devices. Solutions and tips for insulin initiation during COVID-19 pandemic. Now, video demonstration of proper injection technique is one big tool which should be used by all the centers throughout India or throughout the world. This is one technique by which we can reach millions of our patients who are on insulin and teach them a proper injection technique. We need a safe and convenient insulin regimen requiring less monitoring during this COVID-19 pandemic. We need insulin initiation using disposable pens to reinforce simplicity and ease of insulin therapy. Changing of cartridges and needles for a reusable pen may be confusing for the beginners. So you have to initiate insulin using disposable pens, especially if the patients can afford during COVID-19 pandemics. Now, in insulin initiation during COVID-19 pandemic, basal insulin analogs are the simplest and the most convenient option. Preferably to initiate person on basal insulin during patient consultations for remote initiation, video consultations are recommended to ease the person into insulin journey. Start dose of basal insulin analog is 10 units per day or 0.1 to 0.2 units per kg per day. Now, these are the guidelines recommendation on insulin initiation. Till 2016, IDF recommended premix as the insulin initiator. And ACE and ADA also till 2014 were in favor of premix insulin as the first insulin to be used in type 2 diabetic patients who failed on their oral hypoglycemic agents. But now, of all the professional bodies throughout the world, whether it is IDF, ADA, CDA, NICE, RSSDI, all of them, all the guidelines, they are unanimous in recommending basal insulin at initiation. Second generation basal insulin, which is perhaps out of scope to be discussed in this forum, is one of the best insulins which can offer additional benefit of lesser hypoglycemia, lesser variability, safer titration, and greater flexibility. ADA 2021 guidelines recommend basal insulin as the most convenient initial insulin regimen in patients with type 2 diabetes. Now, how to optimally initiate basal insulin? Does one dose fit all? No, not it's not two actually. Global guidelines, ADA 2021 recommendation says that if HbA1c is above target, start basal insulin at 0.1 to 0.2 units per kg body weight, or simply if you are very hesitant, if you are not using insulin a lot, if you are not very confident of using insulin, you can start minimum with the 10 units per day and continue OADs, oral antidiabetics, at the same dose, or down titrate the oral antidiabetics if required. The national guidelines, RSSDI SI 2020 recommendation, you have to initiate insulin on the basis of patient's HbA1c as well as the patient's weight. If the patient's HbA1c is less than 8%, you start with 10 units per day, or you start with 0.1 unit per kg per day. That is, if the patient weighs 60 kgs and his HbA1c is less than 8%, you start with 12 units. If the patient's HbA1c is more than 8%, you start with 0.2 to 0.3 units per kg body weight. So if the patient's weight is 60 kgs and his HbA1c is more than 8%, you start with 18 units per kg body weight, 18 units per day. But just to summarize, just to be very, very safe, if you're not very confident, start with 10 units per day, and you can slowly and gradually up titrate the dose as per patient's fasting blood glucose values, as I'll be showing you in the next slide. Now, basal insulin can additionally address the issues of glycemic variability and time in range. Now, the glycemic variability there has two parts, peaks and troughs. Peaks are because caused by glycemic excursion post-meal PPGs. Basal insulin glargine effectively controls PPG excursions by hitting the base of fasting. And basal offers flexibility of using PPG targeting OADs as well. The troughs or the hypos caused during the interprandial period. Lesser risk with glargine versus NPH, lesser risk with glargine versus premix or co-formulations. Now, insulin once initiated is not adequately up-titrated. Dr. N.K. Singh sir was talking about the inertia, therapeutic inertia in management of heart failure with various drugs. Now, here we also have a therapeutic inertia in terms of insulin up-titration. And we have seen various prescriptions, various referred patients that the insulin dose is not adequately up titrated as patient's blood sugar volume. The average optimization dose of basal insulin remains 18 units in practice in Asian countries. It's a big letdown for us. The maximum dose up to which basal insulin is up titrated should be 0.5 units per kg per day. Now, reason of non-achievement of HbA1c in all our insulin titrated patients: fear of hypoglycemia is one of the most important reasons. Other two very important reasons is lack of titration of insulin. And one most important reason is lack of experience in self-management of insulin dosing. Now, here comes the empowerment of our patients. We have to empower our patients. We have to educate our patients. As Madam was telling that whenever she was starting ARNI or SGLT2 inhibitors to her patients of heart failure, they usually counsel the patients. So whenever we are starting insulin to our type 2 diabetic patients, we have to counsel them. We have to tell them about insulin. We have to teach them about hypoglycemia. We have to teach them about management of minor or moderate hypoglycemia at home. So we should also teach them about up titration of the dose and how do they up titrate the dose. So once you empower your patients, once you educate your patient, it becomes very easy to up titrate the dose. fear of hypoglycemia remains in everyone's mind. All the patients who are on insulin, there is fear of hypoglycemia. So we have to choose our insulin very carefully so that the hypoglycemia is a big demotivating factor in a type 2 diabetic or even type 1 diabetic patient's life. You have to be very, very careful with this side effect of insulin. Now, easy and safe titration with basal insulin. Titration algorithm should be safe and easy. It should be safe, limit hypoglycemia risk, and avoid weight gain concern. And it should be easy. Titration should be flexible, easy to teach and implement. Basal insulin has proven safe and easy titration with different algorithms. These are the different ways by which you can adjust the basal insulin. You can increase one unit or decrease one unit dose adaptation every day. That's the INSIGHT study. You can increase 2 units or decrease 2 units every 3 days, as it was mentioned at Atlantis and Automatic study. Or every 3 days, you take an average of the blood sugar and you can up titrate or down titrate the dose. You can do it weekly as well. And you can teach your patients how he or she can check her blood sugars at home, take an average of last 3 to 4 days and up titrate or down titrate their dosage by 1, 2, or 3 units every week or every 3 to 4 days. Now, this is how to titrate insulin glargine 100 to achieve glycemic goals here. Indian expert opinion on basal insulin titration. Suppose your fasting target is 80 to 130, please continue the same dose. If the patient's fasting is between 131 to 160, you add 2 units of glargine. If it is 161 to 180, add 4 units of glargine. If it is more than 180, add 6 units of glargine. If the sugar goes down, say it's less than 80, you have to decrease it by 2 units. Active titration period lasts up to 12 weeks after the initiation of insulin therapy, period of maximum glycemic burden reduction. Titrate insulin dose based on average of the 3 most recent fasting blood glucose values. Increase dose once or twice a week if fasting is above target. Now, SMBG and insulin titration during COVID-19 pandemic. SMBG should be performed at least twice a week, plus 2 units per week or minus 2 units per week until the fasting glucose target of less than 120 or 110 as you desire is achieved. Initiate within 2 weeks of insulin initiation based on fasting blood glucose readings. Basal insulin analogs maximum dose of 0.5 units per kg per day. Up titration is less challenging with second generation basal insulin analogs such as glargine U300. Person-led titration can be encouraged in motivated and educated persons. Monitor glycemic parameters regularly at least once in 3 months. Now, this is a small study. How we switch to a basal improves the treatment satisfaction of the patient. The study objective was to evaluate efficacy, safety, and treatment satisfaction of glargine plus oral antidiabetics in type 2 diabetes patients previously treated with premixed insulin. Now, the population were type 2 diabetics inadequately controlled with premixed insulin, and they were switched to insulin glargine plus OADs and follow up for 20 weeks. Changes in glycemic parameters, incidence of hypoglycemia, and treatment satisfaction using the DTS questionnaire was done, and outcomes were measured. From the baseline HbA1c 8.3, it went down to 6.9. Fasting 137 went down to 101. PPG 260 went down to 162. Switching to basal plus oral antidiabetes from a premix resulted in improved efficacy with low incidence of hypoglycemia and better treatment satisfaction. All said and done, if you've seen this slide, now, we can also use premix with an educated patient, and we can use premix and we can control his sugar as well. But what I'm trying to say with this slide is that with basal and oral antidiabetics, we can get a better result. We are not putting down premix in any manner, please. Now, ease of less monitoring with basal. There was a paper by Dr. A.K. Singh and Kamlesh Khoti which said that alternatively, to minimize the exposure, even a single per day subcutaneous dose of long-acting basal insulin could be an attractive option. If you want to minimize the exposure to the healthcare provider, there was another paper and which again said that once daily dosing is offered by basal insulin analog is also an attractive option for minimizing the risk of exposure to COVID-19 for healthcare provider. If you're a healthcare provider, if you do not want to come in touch with your patients regularly, you can switch the patients to once daily insulin, which is very, very safe, very few chances of hypoglycemia. And with oral antidiabetics, you can control patients' blood sugar. And during COVID-19 pandemic, when we are not able to meet the patients personally, one-to-one in your chamber, you can still control the patient's blood sugar and keep his glycemic check in control. Now, what are the advantages of basal analogs in COVID-19 pandemic? They're simple and convenient to initiate, easy and safer to titrate, a smooth maintenance period following active titration phase, effective in real practice, less glycemic variability, more time in range, less hypos, less weight gain, ease of training, requirement of less monitoring, flexibility of using OADs. You can always use all the OADs with basal insulin. Improve quality of life, patient satisfaction, ease of remote management is there. You can always guide the patient over WhatsApp, over phone, how to reduce or increase the dose of his basal insulin as per his fasting blood glucose values. There is improved adherence. You are giving only one shot of insulin to the patient, and there is lesser exposure to the healthcare providers in terms of meeting the patient during COVID-19 pandemic. Now, additional advantages of generation 2 basal insulins. Generation 2 basal insulin is one of the best insulins right now in the market to control blood sugars. And we have two contenders for this, Dojo and Degludec. Both are doing extremely well. And they have stable and prolonged actions, less glycemic variability, effective and sustained glycemic control, less overall nocturnal hypoglycemia, safer during titration and maintenance phase, minimal weight gain, flexible dosing. And this is flexible dosing is plus and minus three hours with generation 2 basal insulins. Glargine U300 demonstrated effective and glycemic control with minimal safety concerns in real world data. 1 in 4 patients achieved HbA1c target at 6 months, and 45.5% of patients achieved their HbA1c target at 12 months with the lowest minimal amount of hypoglycemia. The 0.13 documented symptomatic hypoglycemia was noticed. So initiation of glargine 300 in people with type 2 controlled on uncontrolled OADs resulted in improved glycemic control with low rates of hypos and minimal weight change. This is initiation of glargine 300 is safe and effective in elderly in routine clinical practice. If you see the baseline HbA1c from 9.28 to 7.37 in subjects who are less than 70 years of age, and elderly subjects more than 70 years of age, baseline from 9.2 to 7.5. Overall incidence of hypoglycemia event was low at 6 months, 0.0%, and at 12 months, it was just 0.1%. Initiation of glargine U300 is safe and effective in renal impaired in routine clinical practice, and you can use this drug. Again, you see HbA1c reduction 9.32 to 7.47 and 9.27 to 7.37 from baseline to 6 and 12 months in renally impaired group, as well as no renal impairment group. Practical considerations on use of glargine U300. What is the initiation dose? 0.2 units per kg per day. What is the preferred timing of injection? Any time of the day at the same time. Can OADs be continued with glargine 300? Yes, all the OADs can be continued. What is the titration regimen? Can be safely titrated using daily, once in 3 days, or weekly titration schedules? Up to what dose can glargine 300 be titrated? Up to 0.5 units per kg per day. What are the unique advantages of glargine U300 over first generation basal insulin? Well, duration of action is more than 24 hours, lesser variability, flexibility of plus and minus 3 hours, low hypos, low weight gain, safer titration. This is a new pen. I just wanted to show you the picture, the small and thin needle. This is a new Torgio pen, which has come into the market, and it contains 450 units of insulin. All other insulins, they have 300 units. This is more than 450 units. Very lightweight pen. They have given us two samples. It's there in my chamber right now. And these are the various advantages of using the newer pens which have come into the market. So the key message from my presentation will be, basal is the simplest and the most convenient insulin regimen for initiation. Basal insulin offers ease of training and requires lesser monitoring in people with diabetes. Basal insulin offers more adherence, persistence, and treatment satisfaction over premixed. Basal analogs minimize risk of exposure to COVID-19 for healthcare providers. And generation 2 basal insulin like glargine U300 have an array of advantage over generation 1, like lower GV, lesser hypoglycemia, and weight gain. Thank you for your patient hearing. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Ajay Chhabra, for an excellent talk. I just do comments here. One, when we are talking about the history of insulin, we must not forget to honor one person, that is Dr. J.P. Bose, who used insulin for the first time in our country in early 1930s. That, I think, now should become a part of our, one of the slides where should we should also give him honor for using the insulin for the first time in our country.
You for that, I'm doing it.
And second, Dr. Mishra, please mute yourself. And secondly, it's very important, you know, when we talk about initiation of insulin and that to basal insulin, there is no doubt it is universally accepted. It is there in the all the international guidelines. But if you look at the RSSDI-ASI guideline, they have put a tick both on the basal insulin as well as on the premix insulin. And one should realize why they have put both the ticks there. It is because in our country, we have a very high carbohydrate intake and there is the postprandial is very high. And the thumb rule is that when the difference between the fasting and postprandial is more than 80 milligram per gram, then it is advisable to start with a premix, initiate with a premix rather than a basal insulin. So that is one important thing we should not forget, because basal insulin alone will not be able to control your postprandial hyperglycemia, no matter how many OEDs you take. So it is important that if that gap is very high, and especially Indians who have a very high carbohydrate intake, despite the dietary restrictions, we must try to initiate with a premix insulin. I think these are the two points I wanted to make. If there are anybody, Dr. Mishra is there. Dr. Mishra, I think you're joined. Would you like to comment? Now you can unmute yourself. Now yes, you're muted. Please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. So, yes, I totally agree with you. In Indian population, actually, postprandial blood glucose is a problem. That's why premix insulin is very important. Tool in this regard, and in this way we differ from the Western population. And in COVID patient also, since we are patient were on steroid because of the insulin resistance, also postprandial hyperglycemia was a major problem. So as we during the pandemic time, we all are facing in terms of controlling the blood glucose at the postprandial level. Not fasting was not that much a problem. The postprandial was a problem. So yes, again, the premix insulin can be used, but in those subgroup of patients who are on the lower dose of oral anti-diabetic agent, certainly the basal insulin has also some role along simultaneously combined with the sulfonylurea or other agent which can cover the postprandial blood glucose.
Right. Dr. Mishra, your comments?
Yes, yes. Fully agreed, basal insulin and premix insulin both have got some place, their own places in the treatment of diabetes. It all depends upon the quality of patient, types of patient we are treating. I have very large number of patients on basal insulin, but at the same time, there are large number of patients, we fully agree, they have a very high postprandial blood sugar, and those patients cannot be controlled by basal insulin. In this context, one insulin, which is very premix insulin, is very important, in particularly in the Indian settings, that is not 30-70, 50-50. If you're using a 50-50 insulin, because you see a good number of patients, you cannot control with 30-70. There is always a what you call knee-jerk phenomena. How much dose you may use, either patient will go into hypo and hyperglycemia, and then you are in a real trouble. So in those patients, what this 50-50 insulin, particularly not even 25-75, which is quite popular in American communities. But here in India, 50-50 insulin has a big role to play. If you really want to bring down HbA1c less than 7 or around 7, number one. And along with that, you are at the liberty to use various OHAs. Now we are various OHAs are available, particularly good newer OHAs like DPP-4 inhibitors, sometimes even SGLT2 inhibitor as well. And then we have lot of patients who are on various combinations. And if the patient has got very high insulin resistance, then of course voglibose and acarbose who has got very high blood sugar, postprandial blood sugar, then acarbose has a role to play. Or in fact, in India, triple drug therapy is very popular. Like जो मे नॉट बी वेरी मच यू नो रैशनल बट ड्रग्स लाइक ट्रिपल ड्रग कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ वर्गलिवोस मेटफॉर्मिन एंड सल्फोनेरियर लाइक ग्लिपराइड और ग्लिकलाजाइड एक्सा दीज ड्रग्स आर देयर फॉर कंट्रोलिंग ब्लड शुगर बिकॉज ओनली एट द एंड ऑफ द डे यू हैव टू रिमेंबर ओनली वन थिंग दैट इज माय absolutely my philosophy that you have to bring down HbA1c and glycemic variability to the best possible way. That is extremely important. How you may bring down, that is immaterial. If you are bringing down by insulin, if you are bringing down by combination of OHAs and insulin, maybe basal insulin, maybe 50-50 insulin, maybe 30-70 insulin, but the end of the day, the most important thing is that two things are very important. One is the HbA1c and the next is the glycemic variability. So you have to keep the patient its glycemic variability as near normal as possible. Or for in this context, I particularly do lot of tests. Do 41 test I'm very fond of and do regularly in my patient, that is time in range. How much your patient, diabetic patient, is in perfect time in range. The things have gone too far now. No more, there should not be a debate which one is better, basal insulin is better or mixed insulin, because RSSTI advocates, that's why RSSTI advocates both. Premix insulin as well as the basal insulin. So that's how I practice. I don't know about others because I give a lot of importance to two particular investigation. One is the HbA1c and second is time in range for glycemic variability. So if you are able to do it, then it is nothing like that. And you know, all the newer drugs, they have got advantage and disadvantages. Particularly, and you cannot ignore the advantages of newer drugs like DPP-4 inhibitors or SGLT2 inhibitors, or maybe GLP analogs. It all depends upon the particular patient, what is its what is his weight and what is his, phenotype presentation. All these things are extremely important. You have patients who is only 16 years or 15 years, 16 years, and grossly overweight, and then you are in a fix. What to do? Is it, are we treating a diabetic, insulin dependent diabetic patient, or we're dealing something like, type 2 diabetes. So it all depends from patient to patient. That is very, very important. And accordingly, we decide which drug to use. And now, very unfortunately, we have a very large number of molecules to choose in between them. And each molecule has got its own advantages and disadvantages. One cannot ignore and basically play interplay of all these molecules and how much art and science you practice in treating your diabetic patient. That's what I want to say. And this is my comment.
Absolutely right, out. Dr. Mishra. I think you have hit the nail on the head. And it's all a question of individualization. But I just want to make one last comment here. And that's a very, very important issue. See, we talk a lot about insulins. There are so many insulin symposiums going on, and people are talking about starting insulin and initiating and optimizing and intensifying. But nobody talks about what the patient is doing. Is he taking it properly? You know, there is something called insulin rationing, and these patients are not doing insulin rationing. So if you have given them certain dosages, they will cut down into half and say, I'll take half the dose. Why? Not only fear of hypoglycemia, but the cost issue. We are forgetting the cost issue. And I'm very sorry to say that one of the very prolific brand that we use, the price of one cartridge has gone up from rupees 540 to 710 in the last 2 months. The insulin price is increasing like anything. And I don't know why the health minister or the prime minister is not capping prices for the insulin. That's very important. And we as health workers, we as diabetologists, we must ensure and we must pressurize these various multinationals to bring down the price of insulin if we want our patients to get full benefit. That is a very, very important.
Sir, the U100 and U300 are very closely priced right now. So instead of using U100, you can use U300.
No, it's not a question of 100 to 300. Do you know the price of one cartridge of a premixed insulin has shot up from 540 rupees to 710 rupees in last 2 months only? Just one same brand. So, but don't forget, we're writing that, you and I are writing it day in, day out. But when you ask the patient, he said, sir, itna costly ho gaya hai, hum 10 unit kam karke lete hain. And that's why your blood sugar is not being controlled.
Sir, actually,
that is one issue. Yes, price is definitely always a factor in India. But then, by and large, if you are able to convince your patient regarding these two things I talked about,
I'm saying, Dr. Mishra, you can convince your patient to take insulin, exactly. But you cannot stop him from rationing his insulin. You tell him to take 20 units twice daily, he'll take 10 units twice daily because he cannot afford 20 units twice daily. It's question that you cannot do anything about. Yes,
but
Dr. Mishra, you wanted to say
I think if you are able to convince your patient the importance of all these things, then probably and advantages and disadvantages. Unfortunately, in diabetes, what happens? Large number of side effects of uncontrolled diabetes is not absolutely clear to the patient. That like if you have fever, you take paracetamol and the fever goes down. But in diabetes, what happens if things that my HbA1c is 8. Doesn't matter. I have no symptom. I have nothing.
Sir, what Vinay sir was saying about U300 and 100, yes, I totally agree with him that the cost is the same. But actually, the initial which the patient has to pay, that is very, very costly with U300. So the initial cost is more. The patient might not have that much money initially, and to spend that initially, we have to explain it to them that the total expenditure will be the same. So actually only the initial cost matters. Later on,
if you keep
I can tell you, if you tell everything clearly to your patients, then patient will not never say that I will not take 10 units or 15 or 20 units. He'll always take the optimum dose you have prescribed. Otherwise, had it been the case, then probably Rizodeg and Tresiba would completely have been out of market from India at least. They 100%
are the, agree with you, sir. 100%, but not with all patients.
But then you see what you can see how much Rizodeg is selling and how much Tresiba is selling in India, you'll be surprised. So that's why you have a different class of patients.
Yes,
you have
a different
class of patients.
We are not talking about that class of patient who can afford Rizodeg. Yes, Dr. Ajay Chhabra.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. It was my talk, and I thank each and every one of you for listening it very patiently. Our request to Dr. Jagnani will be that we'll be presenting a joint memorandum to the health minister to reduce the price of insulin. And after my presentation, I'll request each one of you to just go to the journal of API, which was published in August 21. And there you find an article by Dr. V. Mohan and Dr. Unnikrishnan and all, where they have mentioned the history of insulin in Indian context. It's a beautiful article. And it mentions in detail about Dr. J.P. Bose, how he started using insulin. That will be a wonderful article tonight if you go through it, and you'll be very surprised, and you'll be very happy to read about the Indian context, Indian part in insulin discovery and as well as insulin journey. Thank you so much for your patient hearing. If Dr. Jagnani allows, we can go ahead with the presentations.
Dr. Jagnani, over to you.
Thank you so much. That was a great discussion. Both medical as well as political. With that, we move to our next talk. Just a minute. Sorry. So we have a next talk. We share the slides. So we are back to CardiabCon with our knowledge partners. And we have now prestigious CardiabCon oration, which has been awarded to Dr. Vinay Dhandania sir, who is a consultant diabetologist at various diabetic centers and hospitals in Ranchi and secretary to RSSDI. Life members to various Indian and global societies, alumni to ISB Hyderabad, principal investigator in various studies, number of national international publications, and hence selected for CardiabCon oration. And he will be talking on use of EHR and telemedicine in this pandemic, which has turned a boon and probably the need of the hour. So, respect, I request you kindly accept the medallion, the memento, and the certificate for this particular oration. With this, I hand over the session to Dr. Jagnani, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Jagnani, please mute everybody. Yeah.
Sir.
Can I proceed? Yep.
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah, thank you very much for this prestigious oration, and it gives me an immense pleasure to present this talk today on EMR and telemedicine. Good evening, respected seniors, dear friends. I congratulate Dr. Jagnani for this excellent program on this particular Sunday, and a good time given to all the speakers for interaction and presentation both. And I could see the participation of all my senior colleagues and friends. Someone has to allow me for sharing my screen.
You can share your screen, sir. It's open, sir. You can share your screen.
Host disabled participant screen sharing.
Aap try kijiye, sir, ho jaye.
Haan, bhi hua, right. So in next 20 to 25 minutes, I'm going to talk on importance of EMR and how does it help in day-to-day clinical practice, and then as well on telemedicine. And let me tell you, we have Dr. Nupurwani on this panel, and I'm proud to say that she's the first consultant here in Ranchi, especially in diabetes practice, to start an EMR from day one of her practice. I do started making a record, but that was on paper and not on EMR. And I started using EMR for last 5 or 6 years, and now I have a good number of patients data on EMR. Now, why this is important? So there is no conflict of interest. I have no financial disclosure for this presentation. If you see the scenarios, different scenarios, how will you intensify therapy in an existing patient with an A1C of 9.6? And referring to the last presentation, like you start insulin therapy, then you titrate it, and then you intensify it. Definitely, if you have a record that what, when did you plan to start insulin therapy and how it has actually helped in reducing the HbA1c and how more intensify you have to make, your previous records are definitely going to be very, very helpful. And then if I would like to conduct a study among type 2 diabetic patients on insulin with CKD above the age of 70, I can have the data immediately, which I'll discuss a little later. And this patient under your treatment for 5 years has lost all his previous records. He's requesting for a copy of his lab investigation since his first visit for reimbursement purposes. And let me tell you, another advantage is patients just traveling to Ranchi from Chadra feels that he needs a consultation. He can even visit your clinic without any files and records. Just enters your clinic for consultation, and you can just by knowing his name, his surname, or his mobile number, you can track his record and give him a good advice. So, what is EMR? An EMR is a digital version of a paper prescription that contains all the information of a patient's medical history from one practice. And it is a very useful digital tool in management of diseases like diabetes, hypertension, CAD, especially chronic cares, where patient needs long-term regular follow-up. And it, why you need an EMR is it documents all aspects of treatment, help in not only retrieving data when needed, but also in medico-legal cases. And track every aspect of patient's health, identify health issues better with organized data, monitor response of treatment, improve quality of care, and reduce errors in prescription, especially in today's era when you have to give patients an option of generic names for all your medicines. For example, when you're writing Emeril M1, you need to write as well glimepiride and metformin in the doses which you prescribe. So communicate enables transparent and informative communication to the patients. And when today you have so many chemist shop, they are very, very likely to make errors in reading prescriptions. And most of the chemist shops are not run by the trained pharmacists. It's very, very unfortunate in our city as we face a lot of problems. So what are the key components? It's the patient management component, it's the clinical component, laboratory component, radiology information system, billing system, everything comes into one platform. If you see the patient management component, it's equipped for patient registration. Patient registration includes key patient information such as demographics, insurance information, contact information, etc. And this gives a very, very important data as far as the demography is concerned, the name of the patient, age, mobile number, existing ID, blood group, email address. This actually helps in actually sending the patients on even email or on their SMS. They can have a PDF format of the prescriptions, address, city, PIN code. And so if it has been referred by some of your senior colleagues or by your colleagues, as you can write, a lot of information which can be put on one particular point, and this is there, it's been stored for always. And in this COVID era, this is also pressing the contacts. If someone is positive in your clinic, you can actually do a contact tracing very, very easy. One of the clinical components, the electronic documentation of such as history and physical examination, consults, discharge summaries, operative notes, etc. Everything can be put in the history, previous hospitalization, previous surgical procedures. So everything can be make a note in the clinic. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The pharmacy system for maintaining a drug formulary, filling prescriptions and cross-checking any orders, nursing component for collection of key patient information. So all these things are very, very important. And this is how you make a record finally, a medical history, allergies, first complaint, current therapies, previous treatment, family history, reviews. Then you can have even personal histories like is a smoker and alcoholic, doing exercise, not doing exercise, tobacco chewer, had previous complications like CKD and diabetic retinopathy. So everything can be made as a record in one particular sheet and doesn't take much time. But till the patients are waiting in the lobby, you can make a record of them. So the laboratory component is also very, very important. The two sub-components are capturing results from the lab machines and integration within orders, billings, and lab machines. I have few POCTs in my clinic, point of care devices, like I can do urine albumin creatinine ratio, HbA1c, lipids, blood sugar using a glucometer. So all these things have been put immediately on the patient's profile, and it comes to my laptop immediately in the clinic. So it has been attached to a system. It can be attached to a system where you have, like a physician orders a test. It goes to the LIM, that is the laboratory integrated module, where the orders are routed to respective labs and the results are returned, are directly available in the physician's EHR. The physicians review the results, then shares the results with the team. He can even have a consult with the different specialties, and it can be finally prescribed. It also goes to the hospital investigation bureau, where the data can be assessed. So everything becomes very, very integrated. And this is a very good model which can be practiced in a hospital setup, because when you're sitting in a clinic room, you are actually seeing a patient, put all your findings, advise them to go to a laboratory. From the laboratory, automatically the data comes to your computer where the patient has been examined. And from there, you advise what medicines has to be taken. And that goes to the pharmacy automatically. And the pharmacy actually gives the delivery of the medicines, explains everything. And that is what is called as an integrated EMR. So all the data are been kept. The data has been stored at the level of physician's room, at the laboratory, and even at the pharmacy as well. So this is how you can store the data: hematology, biochemistry, lipids, liver function, albumin, creatinine ratio, urine routine, thyroid function test, PCOS, and others. Billing system is also very, very important. There are two aspects of billing system which is helpful in our clinic. One aspect is, like, if you are seeing 30 patients, how many of the patients you want to show them for IT department? Most of us don't show all the 30 patients for the IT department. I'm very, very open to share this. So if you want to show all of them, it's very, very good. So you can make a list of all the patients who have been who are paying you for your OPD consultancy, for your pharmacy, for your laboratory. Everything can be billed at that particular time. Patients who want reimbursement can get the bill. So it becomes very, very simple in your clinic to make a process of billing as well. So patients interface of EMR, the patient portal, they can view the history, treatment, and medications, can check on records or additional notes, scheduling their appointments. Software can direct patients to log on into their account and schedule appointments. Right now, we don't have this facility in our country, but surely we are going to have it in near future. So this is how you actually have the final data and the prescription which has been given to the patient, writing the diagnosis, the complaints, vital parameters, and the advice are so very clear. You can actually have different languages for them as well to explain them in Hindi or in Bengali, which is very, very common in our parts. Even we have Kannada and Tamil and all those languages as well. So finally, EMR can be captured by a nurse. All the data can be put in the reception. Even the nurse looks into all the examination part of height, weight, pulse, oxygen saturation, blood pressure, pulse. So everything has been made a note in that particular data. And then the doctor can capture the diagnosis, prescribe advice, test, record prescriptions by selecting from the drug database by brand and by generic names. And the printed prescription is handed over. And if a patient has been on a regular visit, then you can have a graphs and charts also, how the data has been varying. Like the fasting sugar, which was 250 initially, has come down to 150 and 130. So there is a gradual decline in last 6 months or 1 year time. So data analysis can be done. You can tell your patients you are doing much better off, or you can tell your patients that last couple of years was much better, but this year your sugars are going up. So probably your drugs are losing the durability. So you need to change or intensify your therapy. So there are a lot of things that can be actually analyzed from the data. So these are the advantages. It facilitates quick data transfer, improve healthcare quality defined by adherence to guidelines and decreased errors, enhances safety and efficiency, reduce number of lost records, help research activities, allow for a complete set of backups records at low cost, improves patient compliance, facilitate quality assurance, and reduces medical errors, cost saving at the system level for chronic disease prevention and management. So this is what I was talking about. You can find out that between this particular time, how much type 1 diabetes you had, how much type secondary to pancreatitis. So this is the type of data you can actually generate from your EMR. Similarly, last 2 years time, how many of your patients has GDM, how many patients coming with GDM. So again, you can generate data. Even the MCI recommendations keep records for 3 years from the date of commencement of the treatment. If demanded, issue in 72 hours, maintain a register for medical certificates giving full details of certificate issued, and efforts will be made to computerize medical records for quick retrieval. So this is 2002, but still, I don't know. I'm not sure if it has been very strongly implemented in day-to-day practice. You can have a cloud-based hosting through different companies, and you can have integration offering e-prescription electronically, ordering laboratory tests and results. Very useful in teleconsultation, which we are going to discuss a little later, especially during this pandemic. Many vendors are willing to build up additional integration according to your need, and the cost is, the initial cost is definitely there. The annual maintenance cost is still there, but it gives a lot of cost benefits as well in day-to-day practice. The commonly used EMRs are OneGlance, which is very, very popular. HealthPlix is another popular one. DocPlus, then we have DocOn. A lot of Practo is very, very popular in West. So these are few ready-made EMRs which are available. You can also customize your own medical record system according to your need and your practice. Some people have both OPD, a nursing home, a pharmacy, everything in one setup. So accordingly, they can customize their own EMR as well. This is an illustration of EMR in setup of Dr. Mohan's Diabetes Clinic. If you see right from the front desk with the appointment registration, then the patient goes to the OPD clinic for personal, family history, anthropometry by a nursing staff. Then from there, it goes to the consultant who takes the medical history, physical examination, and suggest what important tests are needed, goes to the billing, goes to the laboratory, the tests are been done. With the test, the patient visits to the primary consultant, goes for diet and education, pharmacy, and then goes then visits for the next follow-up. So this is a very, very routine type of practice. And even most of the system has been followed in our clinics as well, very, very similar pattern of consultation. So it also helps in clinical and research applications. These are the clinical applications, the research applications. So to summarize EMR, EMR is a valuable tool for both clinical and research applications. The EMR system can help in standardizing various procedures and has enhanced the quality assurance program. A strategy focused on financial support, multiple networking, and training of technical support staff may be necessary to promote broader adoption of the EMR system by medical service providers in India and other developing countries. One biggest challenge with EMR today is data safety and data protection. The patients are always concerned that we may use their data for anything for our, they are not very, very confident many a times that are their data safe, confidential. So we don't have much answers at present to this particular data safety. Even the cloud-based softwares which are available today with different names, we are not sure whether these data are being safe and those companies are not using these data. Though they are password protected, but we still don't have much answers regarding the data safety in today's scenario in our country. But we are looking forward for all the measures for data safety in clinical practice as well. So with this, I move on to telemedicine practice guidelines. And I'm very happy to share this, that this telemedicine practice guidelines 2020 came up in a very important time of COVID pandemic, where when we needed the most. And the Board of Governors in super session of the Medical Council of India, 25th March 2020, this constitutes Appendix 5 of the Indian Medical Council Professional Conduct Etiquettes and Ethics Regulation 2002. And it was prepared in partnership with Niti Aayog. And I'm very happy to present this as it is in front of all of you. And this is very, very helpful and very useful as well. The points to discuss here is definition of telemedicine, telehealth and RMP, scope of telemedicine, applications of telemedicine, technology used, mode of communications, guidelines for telemedicine in India, teleconsultation processes, the first consultation, the follow-up consultation. And the important definitions are, it's very, very important to understand the very minute differences between the two terminologies, telemedicine and telehealth. Telemedicine is basically delivery of healthcare services using information and communication technologies for exchange of valid information on the following topics: diagnosis, treatment and prevention of disease and injuries, research and evaluation, education of healthcare providers, and the basic aim is advancing the health of individual and communities. And the telehealth, on the other hand, is delivery and facilitation of health and health related services by telecommunications and digital communication technologies. So if you have a project by mechanism of telehealth, you can actually enroll it in the community. The services include medical care, provider and patient education, health information services, and self-care. And this telehealth has actually helped in a repeated change in the COVID protocol, which has happened during this time of pandemic, the vaccination protocol. So all these things has come up with telehealth. And registered medical practitioner, a person enrolled in the state medical register or the Indian medical register under the Indian Medical Council Act 1956, IMC Act 1956. So the background of this presentation is, in India, in-person healthcare is challenging due to large geographical distances, limited resources, and the result of mainstreaming telemedicine in health system is to minimize inequity and barriers to access, reduce the burden on secondary hospitals. Meaning to say, if someone sitting in Chatra wants to have a consultation in Ranchi or Jamshedpur, or for that matter, even in Dhanbad, should have an access to get the best of the facilities, and to save a lot of time of traveling and resources and cost for traveling from all the way from Chatra to Jamshedpur or Dhanbad, or for that matter, even to Ranchi. So he can have the best possible advice sitting there. And this will reduce the burden on secondary hospitals as well. So to date, concerns on the practice of telemedicine, lack of clear guidelines has led to significantly ambiguity in RMPs, and gaps in legislation and ambiguity of rules present a risk of doctors and their patients. I still remember Apollo Hospital had started telemedicine long back, 10 years back, and we were trying to tie up with these people to have super specialty consultation, but there were a lot of issues as far as the guidelines were concerned, and about the authenticity of the consultation was concerned. So finally, we had to give up that telemedicine department in our hospital. So now we have this recommendation from Niti Aayog itself. So what are the benefits? Timely access to appropriate interventions, saving of cost and effort, reduce the inconvenience impact of family and caregivers, can improve patient adherence, can enable availability of vital parameters to medical service devices, maintenance of records and documentations, thus increasing legal protection of both parties. So all these things are very, very important. Each and every treatment is very, very important. For example, someone sitting in Chatra wants to have a consultation with Dr. Ajay Chabra regarding initiation of insulin. So he can have documentation from both the aspects, from the RMP sitting in Chatra and from the from Dr. Ajay Chabra sitting in Ranchi. So both of them can decide for the better rule of the patients, and that can be documented. So that will give a very, very good way of telemedicine. And they can have a regular follow-up as well for titration and intensification sitting up there. So even the RMP learns how to initiate and titrate insulin. And at the same time, the patient is also benefited. The care of the patient is also benefited. The purpose is give practical advice to doctors and encourage them to consider the use of telemedicine as a part of normal practice, assist RMPs in providing effective and safe medical care. Like we heard even in heart failure presentation, the four pillars. So like we sitting in Ranchi can have a consultation from cardiologist in Varanasi or somewhere in Medanta regarding how to carefully use all the four pillars in difficult patients. So that is how the patient can also have confidence in front of you that we are taking an assistance from a super specialist in from a very trained area. So that is how you can actually improve the care and make the patient safe as well. It also helps RMPs realize the full potential of technology for healthcare delivery and provide information on various aspects of telemedicine. So guidelines should be used in conjunction with other clinical standards, protocols, policies, and procedures, which we'll discuss a little later. So scope of the this telemedicine is published under the IMC Act and are of privileged access only. Enable RMPs to effectively leverage telemedicine to enhance healthcare services and access to all. Cover norms and standards of the RMP to consult patients via telemedicine. And telemedicine is all channels of communication with the patient that leverage information. Technology platforms, including voice, audio, text, and digital data exchange. So everything can be included from telephone calls to audio to video to chat, everything. So the guidelines exclude the following. This is also very, very important to know what is not included in the guidelines. A specification for hardware or software, infrastructure building and maintenance, data management system involved, standards and interoperability, use of digital technology to conduct surgical or invasive procedures remotely. This cannot be done. Other aspects of telehealth like research and evaluation or continuing education of healthcare workers and does not provide for consultation outside the jurisdiction of India. So this is also very, very important that this should be kept in mind that who should not be taken into an account for telemedicine. And telemedicine applications, suitable telemedicine tools available for carrying out technology-based patients, consultation, telephone, video devices, available chat platforms like WhatsApp, Facebook messengers, available digital platforms, Skype and email. The core principle of telemedicine practice remains the same regardless of the tools and communications which are available. Now, these are important components, the different types, four basic types on the basis of mode of communication, timing of information transmitted, purpose of consultation, individuals involved. So the mode of communications we have discussed, video, audio, text, specs, everything. The timing is very, very important. The real-time video, audio, text, or interaction, or the patient has asynchronous exchange of relevant information, like you have the data and you discuss with someone else and then tell your patients. Purpose of consultation for non-emergency consultations. First consult with any RMP for diagnosis, treatment, health education, counseling, and follow-up consult with the same RMP for ongoing treatment with the same RMP who prescribed the treatment in an earlier inpatient. So this is what I was talking about, someone sitting in Chatra and taking consultation from Dr. Ajay Chabra. Now for emergency consult and when alternative care is not available for emergency cases, the patient advised for an immediate in-person interaction with an RMP. So this is also been allowed in this particular guideline. And individuals involved is patient to the RMP, caregiver to the RMP, RMP to RMP, healthcare worker to RMP. So these are four different types of this particular telemedicine guidelines. The technology used and mode of communications, video, audio, text-based, asynchronous, these are definitely very, very important. And every different modes have their strengths and limitations according to the availabilities. The guidelines for telemedicine in India, seven elements. These are all very, very important to know and to understand when you are actually doing a teleconsultation. The context is very important. RMPs should consider the following, whether telemedicine or in-person consultation is appropriate for the patient. Choose the appropriate mode technologies available and their adequacy for a diagnosis, complexity of the patient's health condition, and same standard of care as in an in-person consultation, but within the intrinsic limit of telemedicine. This is very, very important, that which can be provided to the patients in front of you. Identification of RMP and patient is also very important. Both patient and the RMP need to know each other's identity. The RMP should explicitly ask the age of the patient in doubt, seek age proof as well through Aadhaar card or something like that. Minor must consult along with an identified adult. The RMP should inform the patient about his or her name and qualifications. And every RMP shall display the registration number on prescription, website, electronic communications and receipts. Mode of communication is also very, very important. Various technologies are available. Primary three modes are available, video, audio, or text. The strengths, limitation, and appropriateness has been discussed. Situations may demand real-time consultation, voice interaction, or video consultation. It can be even recorded sometimes. Patient consent is very, very important for any telemedicine consultation. Implied consent is also very, very important if the patient initiates the telemedicine consultation. Explicit consent is required if health worker, RMP, or caregiver initiates telemedicine consultation, and the RMP can record an explicit consent in any form. Patient evaluation is also very, very important. Gather sufficient medical information about the patient's condition before making any professional judgment. Supplement information through conversation with a healthcare worker and by any information supported by technology-based tools, and request for additional information of the patient. Maintain all patient records is very, very important. And type of consultation is criteria for the first consult, criteria for the follow-up consult, and not a follow-up if there are new symptoms unrelated to the same health condition or if RNP does not recall the context of previous treatment and advice. For example, if patient has just got viral fever or patient has got UTI and treated completely, then he may not follow up later on. So these are very, very important elements. And the last is the patient management, health education, counseling, prescribing medicines. They are all very, very important. And prescribing medicines via telemedicine, same professional accountability as in the traditional in-person consult. This is very important. Only when adequate and relevant information is gathered, prescribed medicines are in the best interest of the patient. Like Dr. Virmani was talking about the cost. Patient may not like a costly medicine, you have to change the medicine. Prescribing medicines without an appropriate diagnosis, provisional diagnosis, will amount to a professional misconduct. So be very, very cautious in doing telemedicine. It's very, very important for all of us to understand this limitation. So prescribing medicines, what are the specific restrictions? So following categories of medicines can be prescribed by a teleconsultation. List O is safe to be prescribed, like paracetamol, ORS, cough lozenges, etc., deemed necessary during public health emergencies like COVID. List A is can be prescribed during the first consult, video consult, re-prescribed for refill in case of follow-up, like in diabetes, newly diagnosed diabetes, relatively safe, low potential for abuse. And list B can be prescribed in follow-up consultation in addition to medication prescribed during in-person consult for the same medical condition. And the prohibited list is very, very important. We keep prescribing drugs like Ultracet very, very commonly. We should be very, very careful in prescribing drugs like Ultracet. It cannot be prescribed in telemedicine due to high potential of abuse. Medicines listed in Schedule H of Drug and Cosmetic Act and rules, and any narcotic and psychotropic substances listed in the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substance Act 1985 should not be used in teleconsultation. Prescription and transmit. Prescription as per the Indian Medical Council regulation should not contravene the provisions of the Drugs and Cosmetic Acts and rules, and provide photo, scan, digital copy of a signed prescription or e-prescription to the patient by email or any messaging platform. And in case prescription is sent directly to a pharmacy, RMP must ensure explicitly consent of the patient that entitles him or her to get the medicine dispensed from any pharmacy or for his or her choice. And fees for the teleconsultation is treated the same way as in-person consultation from a fee perspective. The RMP may charge as appropriate fee for the telemedicine consultation provided. And an RMP should also give a receipt invoice of the fee charged for providing telemedicine-based consultation. And this is the sample prescription format for teleconsultation. So I'm sure we all have done a lot of teleconsultation in this pandemic time, all of us. We were really confused initially how to go about it. A lot of companies and a lot of even pharma companies were giving us some software, some tools to actually deposit money and doing video calls and doing teleconsultation. But the actual guideline came up, which actually helped us in doing telemedicine practice in this pandemic time. So this is the process. The first consult, the patient is here, video, audio, text, patient identification, consent, quick access if emergency care is required, yes, no. So this is how we have been doing it. And this is how it has been follow up. If you have the record, you can actually do it at any stage. The patient or the RMP can choose or discontinue the teleconsultation. At any step, the RMP may refer or request for an inpatient consultation also. So I thank you all for your patient listening. And I thank the organizers, the Cardiac Dipcon for giving me this opportunity this evening. And I'm very, very thankful to Dr. Jagnani for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vinay, for an excellent oration. Of course, it was expected that you will reach to such high standards. And I think it is time today that all the healthcare professionals should be sensitized for EMR. That's very important. We should all be keeping these records electronically, so that we have good database and we can produce a lot of scientific and research papers. I think since this is an oration, there will be no questions. So we will move on to the next section. Over to you, Dr. Jagnani.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Vinay, for having such a wonderful thing. And of course, this is an in thing and we must embrace it. with this, we move on to the next talk of the CardAbCon. Once again, our knowledge partners. And here we are with Secretary's speech with Dr. Ashutosh Mishra, sir. He will be talking on new role of modern sulfonylureas in management of diabetes. So where do we place sulfonylureas with so many newer drugs which we have in management of diabetes? He's graduate and postgraduate from BHU Varanasi and consultant endocrinologist at Panacea Hospital. He is also director and assistant professor there, and of course national coordinator for various programs and fellowships and deliberations, national and international publications. With that, I request him to kindly accept the medallion, the certificate, and the memento for this talk. Over to Dr. Ashutosh Mishra.
Thank you, Dr. Jagnani. I am listening to the talks from the beginning, and most of the speakers are delivering their talk very nicely, and everybody is gaining knowledge from that. In that scenario, the recent talk, the CardAbCon oration, was excellent one, and I hope it will benefit each and every participant of this conference. So it's now my turn to present a talk, and that is a very relevant topic, that is the role of sulfonylurea in modern clinical practice. So my slides are visible.
Yes, sir.
And it is in full screen mode.
Yes, now it's full screen.
So in next 20 minutes or so, I will be talking about the role of modern sulfonylurea in the management of type 2 diabetes. So this is very important part. So in the beginning, I must say that sulfonylurea is projected like a villain. So modern day villain is Ajmal Kasab, or the olden day villain is Ravana. But if you look at the things closely, you may end up with the hidden heroes like Tatya Tope, who was emphasized less in the history, and Jatayu, the role of Jatayu in Ramayana. So my humble request to each of you is to listen carefully, and let's find it out that do sulfonylurea are that much harmful, or they still have some role in modern clinical practice, particularly in a poor country like India. What should be the role of sulfonylurea in clinical practice? My disclosures are none. It is not a pharmaceutical talk, and I have not got any agenda to put. I'm not promoting any drug. I am just putting science in front of you people and decide, and it will help you people to decide and place sulfonylurea in your clinical practice. So I will be talking about the history of sulfonylurea. We'll take a little bit, one or two slides, the structure of sulfonylurea and how they work, particularly the ischemic preconditioning and their role. Are these all sulfonylureas are same, or they are different, particularly the glimepiride or glipizide or gliclazide? The pleiotropic effect of the sulfonylurea, which is much less emphasized as the new drugs are coming up. The older drugs, the pleiotropic effect is less emphasized. The cardiovascular safety profile. What is the basis of the cardiovascular safety profile of sulfonylurea, and how does it stand till date? The nephroprotective effect of the gliclazide. Do sulfonylurea is also having some nephroprotective effect or not? How much it is true? The risk of hypoglycemia. Is there really a risk of hypoglycemia, or it is a much high identity, and most of the time it is misinterpreted? And comparing the sulfonylurea with the DPP-4 inhibitor, one established drug in the diabetes, and another comparison with the thiazolidinones, particularly the pioglitazone, another established drug in sulfonylurea. So I'm not comparing these drugs with the SGLT2 inhibitor or GLP-1. I'm just going to compare all these drugs with after the GLP-1 and SGLT-2, if you are using metformin, DV4 inhibitor, thiazolidones, acarbose, what is the place of sulfonylurea? And in Indian context, what does the guideline-directed medical therapy tells and the key takeaway? So as the history of insulin was being talked about by Dr. Ajay, so the insulin was discovered in 1920. At that particular time, there was no treatment available, as the speaker was telling that starvation was the only treatment, and most of the people were dying because of unavailability of insulin. So with the advent of insulin, certainly people started receiving insulin, and much more life has been saved because of the insulin. But due course of time, it has been found that since this is the drug which is available in the form of injections, and it will be very painful for the patient to take repeated injection, sulfonylurea was discovered at 1960 particular time. And at that particular time, in the treatment of type 2 diabetes patient, there was one oral anti-diabetic drug which can be placed opposite to the insulin, and the injectable medicine can be weaned off. So we can realize that this was one breakthrough at 1955 or 54. So first time the oral anti-diabetic agent was available, and subsequently metformin was discovered, second generation sulfonylurea, and after that thiazolidone, rediscovery of metformin, GLP-1 receptor agonist, DV4 inhibitor, and now the recent is the SGLT2 inhibitor. So that is the journey of the oral medicine of the sulfonylurea, and how it all started. It all started with the use of sulfa drug, with an observation that use of sulfa drug can cause hypoglycemia once the typhoid patient was treated with the sulfa drug. So there must be something with this sulfa group which is lowering blood sugar. And that was the basis. And on basis of this, first sulfonylurea was discovered in 1955, and it has found glucose lowering property in type 2 diabetes. So now we have first generation and second generation sulfonylurea, and the sulfonylurea are having the sulfonyl group and amide group, and this is the common structure which is present. But are all sulfonylureas are same? The answer is no. There is a difference between the different sulfonylurea, and the drug like glimepiride, glibenclamide, that is also called gliburide, they are having longer, larger molecular action, so they may be preferred drug in pregnancy, that they are not going to cross the placenta. So this is one of the advantages. Another important point you can see is the glycolazide, where the molecule structure is completely different. That's why the glycolazide behaves completely different to other sulfonylurea. So there is a difference between the glycolazide, glipizide, and other sulfonylurea. And apart from this, the non-sulfonylurea megalignides are the other group, like ripaglinide, nitaglinide. So here is the table which shows that different sulfonylurea has got different pharmacokinetics and dynamic profile, and how much they are excreted from the kidney and from the liver. I'm not going into the detail, but one thing is very common, that sulfonylurea is one of the excretagogue. Actually, it stimulates the beta cell to secrete insulin. So sulfonylurea is not only available secretagogues. There are other secretagogues also, like GLP-1 receptor agonist. But the GLP-1 receptor agonist is acting as a secretagogue in a glucose-dependent manner. So if somebody is having hyperglycemia, then only it acts as a secretagogue. Apart from this, various agents like GIP receptor agonist, the free fatty acid agonist like GRP40 and GPR119 agonist are also acting as a secretagogues, and they act on the cyclic AMP pathway, and ultimately there is a depolarization, and ultimately there is a secretion of insulin. So that is the common pathway, but the problem with the sulfonylurea are they are acting as a glucose independent manner. So that is the problem. So what happens once you give the sulfonylurea to the patient? You see, here is a normal patient, here is a diabetic patient, where first phase insulin response is blunted. But if you are giving a patient short acting sulfonylurea, the first phase insulin response is restored. Like in case of glycyrrhizide, the dinitaglinide, the dapiglutide, the first phase insulin response is restored once you are giving sulfonylurea. Not only this, the normal physiology, insulin is released into the portal circulation. Once we are administrating insulin subcutaneously, it goes into the systemic circulation and a part of it is going into the portal circulation. But if you are giving sulfonylurea, majority of the junk is going into the portal circulation. That is very important difference between the use of any secretagogue, which is secreting insulin physiologically, and another which you are giving exogenous insulin. Likewise, the hepatic glucose output is decreased. Some of the sulfonylurea can increase the peripheral insulin and peripheral glucose uptake, like GLUT4 receptors, like one of the important molecule is glimepiride. So that is also increasing glucose muscle uptake. So it is not only acting on the beta cell, it is also acting on the liver, it is also acting on the muscle. That is very, very important part. Not only this, it has got some hidden pleiotropic effect and the pancreatic effect. So it stimulates insulin, there is no doubt about that. It has got some extra pancreatic effect, like it reduces the insulin clearance. It has a property to increase the adiponectin level, and it may increase the insulin sensitivity. Apart from this, molecule can act as an antioxidant. This may have some anti-inflammatory property, and they have some effect on anti-angiogenesis also. So in diabetic retinopathy patient, probably where there is a proliferative diabetic retinopathy and you have a choice to use insulin and you have a choice to use sulfonylurea, once it is within the secondary sulfonylurea failure is not there, you can always prefer sulfonylurea over the insulin, because this is the drug which can decrease vascular endothelial growth factor. Not only this, if you are treating a patient of ED and the testosterone levels are low, you may use the thiazolidones and sulfonylurea. They can increase the testosterone level, so they can complement the treatment of erectile dysfunction. So there are a lot of possibility actually in terms of pleiotropic effect and endocrine effect. You have to tailor the treatment according to the need of the patient. So does sulfonylurea cause beta cell dysfunction? That is the question which we have been posed about against the sulfonylurea, and time and again it has been emphasized that look, the sulfonylurea is a secretagogue and accelerate beta cell dysfunction. So there is a rapid decline of beta cell dysfunction, secondary sulfonylurea, and your patient will land up into ultimately insulin. So there is a lot of beta cell dysfunction. Does it really holds true in clinical practice? Let's see with the experiment. Once the beta cell, cultured beta cells were exposed to the higher dose of glibenclamide, then only there is beta cell exhaustion. If there is lower exposure of glibenclamide for a limited period of time, there is less beta cell dysfunction. So this is very important. So what information we can draw from this chart? That if sulfonylurea is having short action, if they are used in a lower dose, probably rate of decline of beta cell will remain comparable to as other drug. And this is shown by this graph, which you can see that data derived from the UK PDF follow-up data from last 10 years. And you can see that though there is an early decline of beta cell function with the use of sulfonylurea, but ultimately it is parallel to the other drug like metformin. So you can see the rate of decline of beta cell is same with the metformin and sulfonylurea after certain period of time, as it is going parallel. So the thing that beta cell dysfunction is accelerated by the sulfonylurea holds true in only 3 to 4 weeks of the treatment. After that, actually, it behaves like metformin once you are using judiciously this agent. What about the sulfonylurea and CV safety? So the most of the time we are feared about the ischemic preconditioning, and that is the most important part, that if there is a ischemic event, the ATP will decrease and this will open the calcium channel, potassium channel, and because of this there will be increased size of myocardial infarction. But in reality, if you are giving this sulfonylurea for the limited period of time, there can be brief increase in contractility that can improve the CHF. So on contrary, it can have a protective effect. But if you are giving longer acting sulfonylurea in higher dose, it may have deleterious effect. So actually, in terms of ischemic preconditioning also, if you are using longer acting sulfonylurea in higher dose, then only it is a deleterious effect. In lower dose, these agents can improve LV function even in acute worsening heart failure patient. So this may be very different drug, and probably it can give an edge to DPP-4 inhibitor. That is why the Carolina trial has shown some different result. As we have seen, there is a comparison between the DPP-4 inhibitor and sulfonylurea. I'm coming to that in the latter part of my talk. So notion that the sulfonylurea is not a cardiovascular safe drug. Where does it come from? The information comes from UGDP trial. So, you know, this trial is done in 1969, and in the way back in 1961, the enrolled was the patient were enrolled and it was stopped in 1969. So we are relying on a trial approximately 60 year old. So this is the trial where at that particular time, there was no concept of matching the group. There was no concept of statistical power. So a lot of caveat from this trial, and the limitation of study, that there was no CVOT criteria available at that particular time. This study was underpowered. The baseline CV characteristics were not matched. Then statistical significance was not there. Concept of statistical significance was not there. So the inference from this trial is really, really questionable. What about other reports in subsequent modern time, of particularly after 1996 or 1998? All the reports which were coming after that, they have categorically shown that both short-term and long-term mortality is not affected by the use of sulfonylurea, and even the most stronger sulfonylurea and longer acting sulfonylurea like glibenclamide is not having any bad effect, and newer generation glipizide and glimepiride drug may be having better outcome as compared to glibenclamide. So there is really a doubt that really these drugs are having any deleterious effect on myocardium. Not only this, actually the bad effect of the bad cardiovascular outcome is mainly because of the presence of diabetes. It is not because of the presence of the drug, or you can say it is because of the common risk factor of the diabetes and the cardiovascular disease, the deleterious effect is there. So whether the patient is having diabetes or not, whether the patient is having multiple risk factors or not, that is actually going to decide the cardiovascular outcome, not the use of the sulfonylurea. So this is very, very important. And you can see in this trial, they have evaluated in-hospital mortality. And in this trial, they have used glibenclamide. And you can see that there is no effect of use of sulfonylurea with respect to the mortality. What about the well-designed randomized controlled trial with some sufficient power, with everybody is believing, the UKPDS. The UKPDS is landmark trial in type 2 diabetes, and we can trust the data, we can trust the number of patients enrolled, and it has got longer follow-up over a period of 15 years. And what does this trial shows? That use of sulfonylurea is not going to increase cardiovascular mortality. So here you can see, if you are using the sulfonylurea, the mortality is not increased. Actually, it behaves same. And if you are treating your patient more intensively. So in intensive treatment arm, probably the outcome was better, whether you are using metformin or whether you are using sulfonylurea. So it doesn't tell that actually sulfonylurea has got deleterious effect. It is comparable to placebo, and if you are able to maintain the blood glucose level and avoiding hypoglycemia, probably outcome will remain same. So that is the inference we can draw from a landmark trial of 15-year duration, that is UK PDS trial. So this is the amount of evidence we have till date. So what about Steno 2 trial? Another landmark trial which came in around 2008. And what it says that in intensive arm as compared to the conventional arm, there was a positive effect. So you can see if you want to decrease the cardiovascular mortality, you have to intervene in your patient in a multifaceted way. Like you have to control blood pressure, you have to control proteinuria, you have to control lipid, you have to control blood pressure, you have to control weight. And because of all these multiple intervention, actually you can give benefit to the patient. So that's what the Steno 2 trial was. And what was the drug which was used in the Steno 2 trial? The metformin and sulfonylurea. And you can see the pioglitazone, hardly any pioglitazone was there. So the only two drugs were available at that particular time in that that trial, the sulfonylurea and metformin. And look at the percentage, approximately 56%, 53%. So half of the patient were receiving sulfonylurea. And in spite of so much amount of the patient receiving sulfonylurea, if you have given multifaceted intervention, the outcome is better than UKPDS trial. So that's solved the all problem, and it gives a hint, important hint, that sulfonylureas are not that bad. And glycolazide was the sulfonylurea used in Steno 2 trial. Apart from this, the much notorious trial like ADVANCE trial, you can see even if there was some deleterious result from the ADVANCE trial, look at the curve. They are approximately going neck and neck, and only after 60-65 month the curve has separated and crocodile jaw is just opening up. So you can see that up to a period of 60 months, there was hardly any difference in terms of cardiovascular mortality. So this also gives a quite insurance that sulfonylurea is safe for up to a period of 60 months. So that is very, very important information. What about the different meta-analysis? So in different meta-analysis has also proven that if you are using sulfonylurea, actually, at least they are not having so many deleterious effect on cardiovascular profile. So that thing is being derived from the that particularly ill-designed trial, that is UKPD trial. So what about the recent trial which has come recently, that is the Carolina trial? And in Carolina trial, they have compared linagliptin with the glamparide, and with what they come out with, that linagliptin and glamparide, they are having equal cardiovascular safety profile and mortality. So in Carolina trial, the glamparide is equivalent to linagliptin in terms of cardiovascular profile. However, in older patient, the hypoglycemia and fracture risks were favoring the linagliptin, not the glamparide. So the main concern was hypoglycemia and the fracture. That was a very, very important point. And you can see, even if you subdivide the dose with the subgroup analysis, the patient who are having age group of 65 to 75, they only have the clinically significant risk. The other groups were not having clinically significant risk in terms of cardiovascular profile. So this is very, very important data, that most of the things were same. And the agent which was used in this was glamparide, a longer acting sulfonylurea. A certain acting sulfonylurea like glipizide, rifaglinide may have some different result, may be superiority. And you can see all the subgroup analysis, they are falling in one line. So there is hardly any difference between these two drugs apart from the non-fatal stroke data, which was mainly there in the 65 to 75 year old. So in terms of stroke, yes, there is some benefit. In terms of other thing, there's hardly any difference. But look at the hospitalization for the heart failure. It is increased little bit in terms of, in case of linagliptin. So linagliptin has increased trend towards the increased hospitalization. So till now we have learned that sulfonylurea and glimepiride, they are particularly having same cardiovascular safety. The DPP-4 inhibitor and sulfonylurea are having probably same cardiovascular safety. The DPP-4 inhibitors are having more chances of heart failure. The sulfonylurea, they are having more chances of hypoglycemia. So this is one thing. What about the nephroprotection? So if you control your blood glucose in a kidney patient in type 2 diabetes, avoiding hypoglycemia, you can have a favorable effect in terms of renal outcome. So renal outcome is favorably affected once you are using glycolide. So this is very, very important. Not only this, on the cognition also, if you are seeing the sulfonylurea and linagliptin, the mini mental risk score remains same, and probably the sulfonylurea and the DPP-4 inhibitors are on the same boat with the, you can see there is hardly any difference in brain cognitive function. So are the sulfonylurea are very effective and durable? The answer is yes, they are quite effective and durable too. And they are far more effective and far more durable than DPP-4 inhibitor, which is the competitor. Another important point is that these sulfonylurea, they have tendency to increase cardiovascular mortality, which has derived from the ACCARD trial, ADVANCED trial, and VADT trial. But and mainly it is because of the hypoglycemia. But if you see the incidence of all hypoglycemia, actually it is increased. But the incidence of severe hypoglycemia, the risk remains same. And as for the ADOPT trial, you can see the glibenclamide was the salt used in this trial. And if you use newer sulfonylurea, modern sulfonylurea, probably you can have similar hypoglycemic profile, hypoglycemia profile as compared to metformin, rosiglitazone, or pioglitazone. What about the comparison between different sulfonylurea like glycolide and glimepiride? You can see that glycolide is superior than glimepiride, and in network meta-analysis also shows that glimepiride and glycolides are better sulfonylurea, and they are probably the agent which can have minimum hypoglycemic event. And if you use these agents judiciously, the hypoglycemia can be minimized. What about sulfonylurea being compared with the pioglitazone? In a tocasite trial, it has been shown that the major cardiovascular event and all-cause mortality were same, and incidence of hospitalization for heart failure were more with the pioglitazone group, while the non-fetal MI and stroke, there was a favorable trend for the pioglitazone. So pioglitazone was reducing MI, pioglitazone was reducing stroke, but pioglitazone was increasing heart failure hospitalization, and that balanced the three-point MACE, and hardly there is any difference between the pioglitazone and sulfonylurea. So again, this is very, very important information that sulfonylurea and pioglitazones are almost on the same boat. And what the Carolina trial has told to us, that these are the subgroup of patients who are enrolled in our clinical practice, which we are seeing the patient in day-to-day clinical practice. They are exactly remain the same. The same time of the patient is enrolled in the Carolina trial, and the outcome was same. And you can see that in Carolina trial, the heart failure hospitalization was more with the linagliptin, and the glimepiride, the hypoglycemia was more. So actually, the hypoglycemia was caused, was increasing cardiovascular mortality, and for the glimepiride, the hospitalization for heart failure was increased by linagliptin. So what are different RCT which are available till date, which shows that, okay, the sulfonylurea is harmful, barring from one particular trial, that is UDGP trial. Other trial have shown that there is no deleterious effect. The meta-analysis have similar results. And if you see the three major randomized control trial has given the clear cut verdict, and they have got sufficient power for longer duration of 6 to 7 years, that all sulfonylurea are probably as CV safe as the BP4 inhibitors and thiazolidinone. So that's why the international consensus, which is given for the South Asian patient and Middle East and African population, what they tell that sulfonylurea is very important drug in our clinical practice. It should be used judiciously, and if you can use these agent, hypoglycemia can be avoided. And for a country like India, where affordability is a problem, sulfonylurea is one drug which still holds promise in clinical practice, and it is very important drug to be used along with the metformin in clinical practice. If you recognize the deleterious effect of the different risk factors, you can judiciously use modern sulfonylurea in your treatment regime. Apart from this, all the primary care setting in our treatment module, which we are seeing that most of the time they are patient population is different as compared to the CVOT trial. So we need a region-specific guideline, and particularly in this region-specific guideline, the sulfonylurea dose and fixed dose combination of metformin and sulfonylurea should be a preferred choice for our South Indian, our Southeast Asian population. So my point is, the sulfonylurea is not a villain. It's not a terrorist. You can utilize it for in the benefit of your patient, and you can give cost benefit analysis, and you can do cost benefit analysis, and you can treat your patient with this agent too. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Ashutosh. It was an excellent defense of sulfonylurea. And I'll not be wrong in saying that almost 70 to 80% of the prescriptions in India have a sulfonylurea as one of the drugs. Now, even though when you look at literature, they say that all the oral anti-diabetic drugs have almost a similar glucose-lowering efficacy, but I feel that in clinical practice we have seen that sulfonylurea are the most potent drugs. And they are, as you very rightly said, the modern sulfonylureas, especially the glimepiride and the glipizide extended release, are wonderful and very potent, especially during the first 5 years, if used during the first 5 years after the onset of diabetes. They have subtle pleiotropic effects. They are cardio safe. And a very interesting paper I read a couple of weeks back, there was a survey in the US on the use of the oral drugs, and they found that after the advent of SGLT2 inhibitors, the use of sulfonylureas was reduced almost by 30 to 40%. But more interestingly, parallel to that, the glycemic low, average HbA1c rose up by 30% in the same population, which again points out the fact that sulfonylureas are very potent drugs and need to be used judiciously in our patients, especially those who do not have any comorbidities. I think that should be our takeaway point. And I don't know if there are any questions, but you have completely very nicely defended and given the right points about sulfonylurea.
Actually, only message just I want to give to the audience that sulfonylureas are not that bad. You have to take account to the affordability of the patient. And in Indian context, it is very much a very under emphasized drug. So we need, if you are using this drug judiciously, certainly this can be a very good weapon in the treatment of diabetes. Now newer drugs are coming up. So in that scenario, people may think that sulfonylureas are outdated drug. So data is not showing like that. So it is a completely different game altogether. Still, we need to learn from the trials, and many more things will come up in the near future.
True. And especially after the Carolina trial, I think there is a rethinking even in the US that glimepiride is one drug that they cannot afford not to use. So that wheel is again turning back, and sulfonylureas will remain with us. I know it is going to remain with us forever. We can't get rid of it.
Yes.
Over to you, Dr. Jagnani, for the next. If there are no questions.
Thank you so much, sir.
May we have some comments from Dr. R.K. Mishra, sir?
Is Dr. R.K. Mishra here? No, I think he's not here at the moment.
Okay, then we move to our next talk. That is with Dr. Sudhanshu Banka. So once again, I'm sharing my slides here. So Dr. Sudhanshu Banka, these are our knowledge partners. So Dr. Sudhanshu Banka will be talking on ophthalmic complications, the evaluation and management of the same in cardiac patients. He is graduate from Bombay and postgraduate from Guwahati and is specialist in phacoemulsification at Patna along with corneal and refractive surgery. So with this warm welcome, I request Dr. Banka to kindly take over the session for the management of ophthalmic complications. Over to Dr. Banka.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Vineet, sir. Thanks a lot. I'll be sharing my screen. Sir, kindly allow me to share my screen, please.
Yes.
Yeah. So thank you Vineet sir for the opportunity, and the topic on which I'll be discussing today is the ophthalmic complications and management of cardiac patients. Whenever a patient comes to an ophthalmologist's office, the patient is actually not just a pair of eyes. There are so many systemic diseases which do manifest in the eye, and many a times we as an ophthalmologist, we ophthalmologists are the first ones to diagnose those conditions. And the objective of this presentation is to describe the ocular signs and symptoms associated with some selected cardiovascular disorders, and to also review the important features of diabetic retinopathy and the current screening guidelines for diabetic retinopathy. There are no financial interests in this presentation, and we all know that the eye disease and cardiovascular disease frequently coexist. And as a result, we often see the same patients, because the same elderly patient who is having atherosclerosis, hypertension, diabetes, is also a patient who tends to develop cataract and glaucoma. At times, these patients overlap between these our offices. And these cardiodiabetic patients and our eye disease patients often share the same pathway of diseases like atherosclerosis and inflammation. They have the shared risk factors like hypertension and cigarette smoking. Cigarette smoking is a very important risk factor for age-related macular degeneration, hyperlipidemia, metabolic syndrome, and diabetes mellitus. Even a few new research papers have suggested that we may even start sharing some treatments in the future, because statins, patients who have been on statins for long term have shown a bit of protection against ARMD, and fenofibrates, which are not too much in use with you people nowadays, but fenofibrates have shown protective against diabetic retinopathy. The signs of risk factors of severe cardiovascular diseases and eye disease are often the same, like changes in the microvasculature, embolic phenomena, occlusions, and other ischemic events. Other signs like hypertensive retinopathy, diabetic retinopathy, and xanthelasma, which is nothing but, as you can see in this picture, is nothing but a deposition of lipid or cholesterol on the eyelids. Ophthalmologist roles arises in spotting the earliest signs and monitoring of the high-risk patients, and also monitoring the drug side effects. Some important drugs which are used by cardiologists like you people are like amiodarone, which can cause vortex keratopathy by deposition of the drug into the whorl-like patterns on the cornea, or digoxin, which can cause maculopathy. Antihypertensives, if the patient the hypertension is controlled very quickly, then it can lead to ischemic events in the eye. And beta blockers, which are used as antihypertensives, can lead to dry eye in our patients. It's not just that drugs which cardiologists use can cause side effects in the eye, but drugs which we use, like anti-VEGF therapy, which is the mainstay of now any for treatment of any kind of diabetic macular edema or any other macular edema due to inflammation or venous occlusions. Anti-VEGF therapy can lead to, if given injudiciously, can lead to have theoretical risk of causing cardiovascular events. And beta blockers, which we use, like timolol, which we use as anti-glaucoma medications, can lead also be deleterious in patients with asthma or cardiac patients. I'll be discussing some common features of or common ocular manifestations of some of the cardiac diseases, mainly in the heads of syndromic associations, congenital cyanotic heart disease, acquired heart disease, and systemic diseases leading to cardiac and ophthalmic diseases like hypertension and diabetes mellitus. The first one which I will discuss is a Marfan syndrome, which a patient with Marfan syndrome can often present to your office with mitral valve prolapse, aortic regurgitation, or aortic dissection. And this patient can also have subluxation of the natural lens, which is ectopia lentis. The subluxation is often supranasal. Or these patients often have high myopia and are predisposed to retinal detachment. Depending upon the condition, if it's just a myopia, we give a spectacle correction. For ectopia lentis, the treatment of choice is lensectomy and special type of IOL fixation, which is a scleral fixated IOL. And for retinal detachment, definitely, depending upon the extent of detachment, the type of RD surgery will be chosen by your treating ophthalmologist. Patients having charge association can present with iris coloboma. Apart from heart disease, they can present with iris coloboma or a chorioretinal coloboma. You can see this iris. There is an inferonasal coloboma. The inferior portion of the iris is not formed completely. And this portion, in this fundus picture, you can see that inferior retinochoroidal coloboma is there. Chromosomal anomalies like Down syndrome, Turner syndrome, other trisomy 18 can have ocular manifestations in the form of microphthalmos or anomalies of the palpable fissure, like in this picture. This child is having a blepharophimosis syndrome, and there can be epicanthal folds, refractive errors, and one important disease which can need surgical correction, often needs surgical correction in these patients, is a congenital cataract or a developmental cataract. Some intrauterine infections like congenital rubella can again manifest with cataract, congenital cataract, or chorioretinitis in the patients, microophthalmos, and corneal opacities. Patients with fetal alcohol syndrome, apart from cardiac anomalies, they can show short palpable fissure, ptosis, and microophthalmos. Acquired ocular features in congenital heart disease is mainly seen in patients having cyanotic congenital heart diseases, and they often present with retinal and disc edema and vascular tortuosity. Patients with infective endocarditis, they can have mainly retinal changes in the form of either hemorrhages or a white-centered hemorrhage, as seen in this picture, which are known as the dark spots. These patients with infective endocarditis, if infective emboli is there, can also cause endogenous endophthalmitis in the patient, which can often present as an infection of the internal coats of the eye. The mitral valve prolapse can cause amaurosis fugax and central and branch retinal artery occlusions, secondary to platelet emboli. This fundus picture, although the picture quality is not very good, if you can see the embolus here, this patient had presented to this. She was a principal of one of the reputed schools of Patna, and she has presented to me with an altitudinal field defect in her vision. On examination, I could see an embolus lodged in the superotemporal artery. So it was a case of branch retinal arterial occlusion. If you can make out, this portion of the retina is paler as compared to the rest of the retina because the blood supply has been stopped. Now, when we evaluated her further with the help of a physician, she had a plaque in her carotid arteries. Patients with aortic arch syndrome manifestations may depend upon the underlying condition and the site of occlusion. These patients often present with ocular ischemia and hypoperfusion, venous dilatation, venous bleeding, cotton wool spots, which are nothing but infarcts in the retinal nerve fiber layer, and microaneurysms may occur, which can also lead to because of ocular ischemia, peripheral retinal hemorrhages, and retinal neovascularization is also one of the features of patients with aortic arch syndrome. Signs of ocular inflammation such as vascular injection and flare in the anterior chamber can also be seen. And cataract formation can also be seen in the later stages of these patients. Takayasu's disease, which is a chronic granulomatous vasculitis, there can be a narrowing and occlusion of major branches of the aorta, including the carotid arteries. And this condition can typically, in young people, can cause scleritis or aritis and also hypertensive retinopathy changes. Coming to the systemic diseases, hypertension, as we know, it may cause damage to the heart, kidneys, brain, and eye. And in the eye, it can cause damage to retina, choroid, and the optic nerve. The changes can be both acute and chronic changes. The ocular findings are mainly seen in the form of arteriolar narrowing and AV crossing changes in the form of AV nicking, cotton wool spots, retinal hemorrhages, optic nerve swelling, which is the edema of the optic nerve head, and retinal ischemia and neovascularization. Many times, hypertensive retinopathy is also associated with conditions like branch retinal artery occlusion, BRAO, BRVO, which is the venous occlusion, or central retinal artery or central retinal vein occlusion. In this fundus picture, you can see all the changes of hypertensive retinopathy. For example, the first arrow is pointing towards the AV nicking. You can see the area where the artery is crossing the vein is constricted on both the sides of the crossing. This is a AV crossing changes. There's an arteriolar attenuation. You can see the lumen of the arteries is very much narrowed in this patient. These white spots are known as cotton wool spots. These are nothing but infarcts of the retinal nerve fiber layer, as well as deposition of some lipid into the macula, which is a hard exudate. In malignant hypertension, we can see the swelling of the optic nerve head, which is also disc edema or papilledema, as you may call. And this fundus picture is showing a patient with hypertension, having uncontrolled hypertension, and having an occlusion of the inferotemporal branch of the vein. So it was a case of BRVO. This is a fundus picture with fluorescein angiography of a patient with CRVO, that is the central retinal vein occlusion. Again, this patient was a uncontrolled hypertensive. So current concepts in the treatment of hypertensive patients having ocular signs revolve around they say that the hypertensive retinopathy signs may be indicator of blood pressure control, and the generalized retinal arteriolar narrowing and AV crossing changes are signs of long-term hypertension, and they can be independently associated with past blood pressure levels measured up to 10 years before retinal assessments, whereas the focal changes in the form of focal arterial narrowing or retinopathy lesions like cotton wool spots, microaneurysms, or hemorrhages, they more or less represent transitory blood pressure changes and can be related only to concurrently measured blood pressure. And the longitudinal data from recent population-based studies have demonstrated that smaller retinal arterial and large venular calibers precede clinical stages of hypertension. There is a strong link between hypertensive retinopathy and the risk and incident of future cerebrovascular and even cardiovascular events. The management of hypertensive retinopathy revolves around routine monitoring and blood pressure control, monitoring of vascular risk, treating acute changes and complications of hypertension. For example, a patient showing BRVO or CRVO, we need to treat that with the help of anti-VEGF injections or lasers, whatever is desirable and the condition of patient warrants. We always desire that the BP should be controlled in a gradual manner rather than a precipitous decrease in blood pressure, because a fast decrease in blood pressure can many a times lead to ischemic events in the eye. Anti-VEGFs in the case of macular edema, as I've already said, and due to venous occlusions. The screening is very important, and with the advent of artificial intelligence and deep machine learning, this thing is coming more to the forefront nowadays. Now algorithms have been developed where future prediction of cardiovascular and cerebrovascular events can be done with the help of the fundus picture of the patients. And it also helps in screening for white coat hypertension and response of the patient to the treatment. One important aspect which I would like to highlight is the patients of glaucoma who have hypertension. Now, hypertension in itself is a risk factor for glaucoma. But at the same time, when we treat hypertension and if we allow nocturnal hypotension in these patients, then this can enhance progression of glaucoma. Coming to diabetes, we know that India is we are going to have an epidemic of diabetes, and India is going to be a diabetic capital of the world. And diabetes do affect the eyesight in many ways, and in many cases it has been suggested as a possible risk factor, like patients having retinal venous occlusions or arterial emboli, and corneal diseases like corneal erosions and persistent epithelial defects, or what is collectively known as diabetic keratopathy. And sometimes it can be a cause of non-healing corneal ulcers. Diseases like primary open angle glaucoma and neovascular glaucoma, diabetes is a definitive known risk factor, and also in the case of ocular ischemic syndromes. Now, ocular conditions which are all 100% associated with diabetes mellitus are cataract, AION, which is an ischemic optic neuropathy, diabetic papillopathy, and ocular movement disorders. The microvascular changes in the brain, they can sometimes lead to the sixth nerve or the fourth nerve palsy, leading to ocular movement disorders, and of course, diabetic retinopathy. Now, diabetic retinopathy, almost two-thirds of all type 2 patients and almost all of the type 1 patients are going to develop diabetic retinopathy over a period of time. And in our country, the prevalence of diabetic retinopathy in diabetics is somewhere around 18 to 22%. There's a huge burden of disease, as the numbers suggest and the prediction suggests that this burden is going to increase. In 2014, we had 12 million patients with diabetes, and which is about to increase to 15 to 16 million by 2030. Diabetes mellitus if we see among all the cause of visual impairments, diabetic retinopathy accounts for almost 1% of the patients with visual impairments. And the same is, we see the patient global causes of blindness, again, it accounts for 1% of these patients. Diabetic retinopathy can be classified into the non-proliferative type and the proliferative type. The NPDR, or the non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, can again be classified in the form of mild, moderate, and severe. Mild diabetic retinopathy, as suggested by this first fundus picture, is the one in which there are less than four microaneurysms or dot hemorrhages in each quadrant. And anything with more than 20, as it's suggested in this middle picture, is a severe type of diabetic retinopathy. Anything lying between severe non-NPDR and mild NPDR is a moderate NPDR. PDR, or proliferative diabetic retinopathy, can manifest in the form of formation of new vessels either at the disc or elsewhere, that is NVD or NVE. And these new vessels on angiography, they show persistent leak of the fluorescein dye. The main cause of visual deterioration in these patients with diabetic retinopathy is either a vitreous hemorrhage, if it's a severe vitreous hemorrhage, then we see nothing in the eye as suggested by these pictures, no fundus details are available. Or it can also, PDR can also lead to tractional retinal detachment as suggested by this last picture, due to PDR, there is a proliferative vitreoretinopathy. There are fibrovascular fronts which have formed and that put some traction on the retina, causing retinal detachment. Another cause, which is of more common cause, you can say, of visual deterioration in diabetic patients, is diabetic macular edema, which on the optical coherence tomography can show these cystic spaces in the retinal layers. Clinically significant macular edema, or CSME, is defined, has got its own definition. Basically, it highlights whether the macular edema is going to cause, if there is a macular edema in the patient, whether it is going to have an impact on the visual condition of the patient or not. The management of diabetic retinopathy is a teamwork between the physician or the diabetologist and the ophthalmologist, because the physician will help us in the maintenance of HbA1c between 6 to 7% and controlling the associated conditions like hypertension, hyperlipidemia, anemia, and renal disease. The treatment of diabetic macular edema is now a mainly dependent upon the anti-VEGFs, like these are the anti-vascular endothelial growth factor agents in the form of ranibizumab or bevacizumab, and intravitreal triamcinolone acetate injections, lasers, or a combination of anti-VEGFs and prompt laser. Anti-VEGFs are the, you can say, gold standard now, or they have given us a shot in our arm to treat macular edema without damaging the retina. Because previously, before the advent of anti-VEGFs, say 15, 16 or 15, 20 years back, lasers were the mainstay. Grid laser or a focal laser was the mainstay for treatment of diabetic macular edema. But when we do laser on the retina, we do damage some retinal layers, and that caused decreased vision. So visual recovery was not always very good with lasers. But with the advent of anti-VEGFs in the form of ranibizumab and bevacizumab or Avastin is of course an off-label use. Ranibizumab is the approved, FDA-approved and drug for treatment of diabetic macular edema. And the treatment of PDR depends upon the condition, whether if it's a case of just a neovascularization on the disc or elsewhere on the retina, a pan-retinal photocoagulation in the form of, with the help of a green argon laser, is sufficient. Otherwise, if it's if those new vessels have leaked, have caused hemorrhage in the retina, or there's a proliferative vitreoretinopathy, then a vitrectomy is needed. Screening is very important for diabetic retinopathy, and screening eye examination for all patients at the time of diagnosis for type 2 patients is recommended, whereas for patients with type 1, that should be done within 5 years of diagnosis. All pregnant patients getting diabetes should be evaluated for diabetic retinopathy, and the follow-up exams will be dependent upon the initial eye findings. The blood glucose, blood pressure, and lipid optimization is always desirable. It is advice for the patient to stop smoking and exercise regularly. So the take-home message with my this talk is that the eyes are windows to the soul and body, and all the patients with cardiovascular diseases should undergo a regular ophthalmic exam, and the teamwork and coordination between the cardiologist and ophthalmologist can help in preservation of the eyesight and management of the systemic disease as well. Many times we'll come across some patients will be adamant will not be willing to listen to us, but at that time we have to show our utmost patience and advise them correctly. In the end, I would say that we all should be willing to donate eyes and promote our patients and educate our patients to donate eyes, because we are in short of, we have got a huge burden of corneal blindness, and the donations are not up to the numbers required. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Manta. Any questions? It is open for the... Any questions? Any comments?
Hello.
Yes. Boliye aap sab.
Actually, it is very nice presentation. And
thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Eye management is very important, and particularly of retinopathy, it's very important. In our hospital also, there is a ophthalmology department associated with the endocrine department. We'll see lots of overlap, and ophthalmologist is actually needed for the comprehensive diabetes care, and most of the time the integration is required. Some of the points which I just like to emphasize in your clinical practice, once you see clinically significant macular edema, what are the things you will advise to we physician that we should take care of so that things cannot be deteriorated, because this is an emergency scenario. So yes. What are your advice and precaution we should take as a treating doctor?
Sir, the only advice which I can give to the treating doctor is that we will need a stricter control of diabetes and associated. The diabetic edema, the main cause of diabetic edema is there is a vascular leakage, and there is a leakage of lipids from the vessels into the retina. So apart from diabetic control, we also need to control other systemic associations, like hyperlipidemia is very common in these patients. So we need a control of hyperlipidemia in these patients, plus overall stabilization. The general condition of the patients needs to be stabilized so that we can proceed with further treatment, because we'll be giving the patients anti-VEGF therapy. And if the patient is non-affording and goes for the cheaper options of bevacizumab, that's a non-selective anti-VEGF that can have an impact on the heart of the eye by causing a cardiovascular event, ischemic event. So that is one thing which I always ask my patients or my physician colleagues, that the general condition of the patients, the general well-being of the patient should be good before I proceed with anti-VEGF injections. Another important aspect is control of the nephropathy. Because if there is water retention in the body, then again the chances of leakage into the retinal layers of or accumulation of fluid in the retinal layers increases. So apart from diabetes, associated conditions like nephropathy and hyperlipidemia are very important to control, to give reasonable chance to the patient for recovery of his or her vision.
Okay. Another drug which we are using nowadays in our clinical practice, that is hydroxychloroquine. So yes, nowadays, the hydroxychloroquine is the one drug which is anti-diabetic drug targeting the inflammation. Yes, so most of physicians are writing hydroxychloroquine as an anti-diabetic drug, and newer oral GLP-1 receptor agonists like semaglutide, and these are also known to increase the diabetic retinopathy. So for a physician, it is mandatory to screen the diabetic retinopathy in each and every patient before prescribing the drug. So what are your advice to reduce the side effect of hydroxychloroquine on retina, and in which patient we should use, or how much dose, or longer duration or shorter duration? What is your take on that?
So hydroxychloroquine, the side effect of hydroxychloroquine on retina is mainly deposition of the drug in the retina and causing maculopathy. But actually speaking, we have seen many patients. We see many patients with arthritis and all who have been chronically taking hydroxychloroquine in high doses as a disease-modifying drug. And we hardly see any patients with deposition of the drug in the retina. Very, very few patients. So even if you are giving hydroxychloroquine as an anti-inflammatory agent in diabetes patient, I am not too much concerned about its retinal side effects. The only thing I'll say is that, yes, again, a regular screening for appearance of any maculopathy, bullseye lesion in the eye should be done same once every 3 to 6 months. If that is being done at the earliest signs of any bullseye maculopathy, we can ask the treating physician to stop hydroxychloroquine. So we're not too much concerned with the retinal side effects of hydroxychloroquine.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Banka.
Thank you, sir.
I'll just removing your screen from here. Sure. Dr. Chawla wants to say something.
No, nothing. I was just waiting. Yeah.
Great. So, kindly accept the certificate of faculty for Dr. Banka.
Thank you, sir.
Back to our